Board of Selectmen meeting for August 9th, 2016.
Plenty of time to muddle through it.
We'll start off, we've got a lot of ground to cover tonight, a lot of very interesting and important topics. Beyond the liaison reports and public comment and the town manager's report, we have an action item on the MWRA, another discussion on senior tax relief and tax classification. We're going to move to a financial review and a Proposition 2.5 override discussion, and then we'll finalize with a discussion regarding a special town meeting and a special election. So we'll start out with liaison reports, and Dan, let's start down at the end and work our way this way.
Other than reviewing the YouTube version of a couple of school committee meetings, no report.
Okay, and I do want to mention that John Arena is here, both watching through a closed circuit webinar and also on the phone with us here. So we actually have all five in participation. John, do you have a report, liaison report?
I don't. In the interest of time, I've got a full schedule, I don't.
Okay, and Barry?
Really quickly, the planning group, group number five of the Vision 2020, we got off the ground first and had our first meeting a couple of weeks ago, where we talked about our plan for filling the role for the economic development planner, some of the zoning stuff, really kind of targeting some economic development thoughts. I thought we had a really good first meeting and really some really good ideas. So that working group is on its way. So thanks to Gene and Bob and Julie and Joe and a couple other folks. We got off to a good start.
I have no reports.
Okay. The only additional meeting that I attended was a school committee meeting about 10 days ago, the focus of which was a discussion on their recent audits with some findings, and I think that they're working through those things. The other major topic of information that came out of the school committee meeting was a discussion of their budget, their finances, their plans to send us some recommendations for our consideration, and they were relative to structural deficit in their budget, as well as some additional topics that they would like to be adding, both of which, one, the first, the structural deficit, carried on a vote of 6-0 to be sent to us for consideration as a final number in reviewing our discussion about a possible override. The second was a list beyond the, and they were separated for a reason, I think. The school committee, by a vote of 4-2, suggested an additional approximately $1.9 million for our consideration. And I think that rather than get into the, you know, to the nuts and bolts of how that happened, Barry was there with me as well. I think that the school committee was happy that we're there from an informational standpoint to really discuss their role in the discussion and how it relates to our responsibilities in the discussion. And I thought it was a good discussion, a good back and forth. And some number of the school committee members will be visiting us on our meeting next Tuesday, the 16th, as we look forward to a discussion on any potential finalization of suggestions for a ballot question in the second, in a special election. So I'm going to kind of shut it off at that, as it's going to be a major topic with a visit from both the school committee and the Board of Library Trustees at our next meeting. That being said, I'd like to open the floor to public comment.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Bill Brown, 29 Road. Can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Sure. Loud and clear.
At the last meeting, there was a question came up about the sign on the common. And I think the town manager said that it was out of the jurisdiction of the Conservation Commission. Just a little history on it. The common was deeded to the town by the parish in 1853. So the donation of land was now Memorial Park in 1917. Park Commission was elected to oversee it together with the common and Mayall Park, which is now the Leech Park. In 1920, the shop there, public works was created with a number of commissions, including the parks, which oversaw the common. In 1986, the charter came into effect, the board of selection became owners of the common. Unless they're written evidence for the contrary, I suggest a few people control it. Thank you.
That's interesting.
Thanks, Bill. Always a fountain of wealth of useful information. Thank you. Any other public comment this evening? Yes.
I got here a little late. Will there be public comment allowed when the tax relief and the proposition 2.5 override is discussed?
It is a discussion, and you know, it's as those of you that have watched us over the course of the last months and years, you know that often the selectmen enter into a discussion period rather than a staged period of items to be covered. It's my opinion, unless there'd be a dissent from any of the other board members, that yes, there certainly will be time for public comment.
Okay,
we would encourage that. We've invited as many people as we could figure out to invite, because this is a very timely and important topic.
Then I'll wait till then. Thank you.
Okay. Any other public comment? Yes.
Hi. I'm Rosemary Murphy on 47 Batchelder Road. I just wanted to voice my concern over the wooden garage, DPW garage, that is being proposed. I voiced my concern for all the residents on Batchelder Road and on Parsons Road. We don't feel this is the right place to have this. Supposedly it was going to be a garage, and now I'm hearing it's a 5,000 square foot garage with a locker room, with showers, with all this housing that's going to be involved in the rear of the cemetery, and it's not the right place for it. It should be on Waffles Brook with the rest of the DPW equipment and housing and all of that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes. From 34 Batchelder Road as well, and I mean, that garage is going to be in my backyard, and I take my kids there to ride the bikes, to play, and there's going to be all this equipment, and the noise, and the traffic, and I just don't understand why it can't be added on to the current building where it should be an industrial park versus a commercial area.
Okay. Other public comment? Yes.
As a member of the cemetery board and trustees, I get on that board. Mm-hmm. And if you look around the town where there is no other place, nowhere. Good job. You talked about putting it down in the DPW. Mm-hmm. When Weston Sampson did the last study on that site, they said there was not room enough. There were 10 less parking spots if they developed it than there are employees. That's not including the public or whatever. It will run between $18 and $22 million for the buildings on that site. We do not intend to put 5,000 square feet at the mall. It would be 4,000 square feet.
Okay, so here's where we are.
Very small, and it's growing.
Can I stop you for a second? We're happy to invite public comment of any kind at this time. What we're not prepared to do is engage in a one-on-one debate between two members of the public. But if, I mean, and we're certainly happy to hear public comment, really on any topic that relates to the town, and this is germane, for sure. It is not an agenda item for us this evening, but your comments are certainly well-placed, as are Mr. Brown's. It sounds as though there's a difference of opinion about that, and ultimately that will end up in the hands of town meeting. Which, you know, an instructional motion from town meeting is actually what's engaged the whole discussion and has engaged the building committee to look and review and, you know, based on that instructional motion, make recommendations, not necessarily to build or not build, but to look at the feasibility, look at potential locations. And so I do think that, it sounds just by way of public comment here this evening, there's clearly a difference of opinion about it. Town meeting is a place that you'll want to be sure to talk to your town meeting members about that, because there'll be a report that will come back to town meeting relative to the instructional motion regarding that topic. So, and I'm happy to take more public comment, but really not open to engage in kind of a one-on-one debate, and I say that with all due respect to both parties. But open to any other public comment, and by all means, I'm sure this is going to be an ongoing topic that's going to be open to public comment both here, and you should definitely consult your town meeting members about your feelings both for and against. My suggestion. Any other public comment? Hearing none, then I'm going to ask the town manager for his report.
I'll defer to next week's town, but I do want to let the public know the permanent building committee did meet last night to discuss the cemetery building project. And just for your information, the next meeting is August 29th.
I'm sorry, when?
The next meeting is August 29th at Town Hall. So if you look on the website and you look under current projects, you'll find cemetery garage up there. I would suggest anyone, and there were five neighbors there last night, I would suggest anyone in the public that wants to be more involved in the process and understand what's going on, August 29th is a good time. And just to echo what Chairman Halsey said a little bit, the town meeting set us on this path. We have the desire to find the best location in a cemetery. So far, the committee's narrowed it to two. So it's one of two cemeteries.
Can you clarify why you're calling it a cemetery when it's DPW and it's snow removal trucks and all of
no,
that?
No, it's not. It's cemetery equipment and cemetery vehicles. Cemetery vehicles do remove snow from cemeteries, though. So it's not the case that something that's not related to the cemetery that's another DPW function would be brought there. It's only cemetery related. And again, I'd encourage you on the 29th to go. The mission of this project is not to build something. It's to come to town meeting with the best information of what is the best location in a cemetery, and that's one option. We hope there's other options. That's all.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I'm late in the tenth, I apologize. Rick Lazaro, 11 Partridge Road. Why does it have to be at the cemetery? Why is it limited to just that as an option?
Well, Rick,
I missed it, I apologize.
Yeah, as I pointed out before you were able to join us, and this is not a chastisement, it's just bringing you up to date.
Yes, again.
We were charged by town meeting to go forward with, by instructional motion, to explore opportunities for a cemetery garage within the confines of one of the cemeteries. And the building committee is going about that business right now. So, based on the instructional motion, that's the reason that they're moving in that direction, to take a look at potential opportunities for such a building, what the building should look like, what that building might potentially cost. These are all items that are flowing back to us by instructional motion from town meeting. So that's the reason the process is underway. I mean, what this process doesn't do is it doesn't certify that A, B, or C is going to be done in X, Y, or Z location. What it does is it creates an understanding of what is potentially viable and what those potential costs would be, and then that will have to return to town meeting for a discussion, capital appropriations if approved, or rejection based on the findings of what happened. So, I mean, I clearly understand why, if my house was next door, I'd be interested in what it meant to me. I mean, certainly I get that, and I understand where everybody's coming from. I would urge, just to echo what the town manager has said, on August 29th, the building committee, the permanent building committee, will be reconvening with this topic in mind. you should be heard as members of the public there, urge you to attend there. And I also would urge you to express your feelings to the appropriate town meeting member that represents you. So that's kind of what, there's not much, I mean, it's really not in our hands. I mean, we're a venue for public comment, for sure, but, you know, we're not in a position to say, yes, go do it, no, don't go do it. That's really kind of flows out of town meeting, because it's a capital project that would need, and they control the purse strings of capital expenditures. Therefore, it would all flow ultimately from there. I think I'm on firm ground when I say that. Is that right, Bob?
That's right.
Hi, Bobby, yes.
Hi, Tom. Bobby Monticelli. I'm co-owner of Colonial Land Realty. I am not affected. My home is not this neighborhood, so personally, I am not affected. But I think I can probably speak better than anyone about the value of the properties there. That Partridge Road is my development that has been in. And it was not easy because there was a cemetery there. And it's sort of like people have gotten over that, sort of, because there's growth and all of that. But now to have any type of garage and noises there is going to absolutely devalue Partridge and Batchelder. There is no question in my mind, well, Parsons also, and there's no doubt in my mind. So if they get devalued, does that mean the town will lower their assessments? I don't think so. So I
wouldn't picture that happening, no.
No. So they're still going to be assessed for what they're assessed for now without that, but their homes are not going to be worth that, and I can assure you. And there was a segment of the population, certain buyers who will not buy near a cemetery. And I would say maybe 30% of the public who will not. Their religion doesn't allow them, the nationality doesn't allow them. And so we're going to lose them, but then we're going to lose the people who just don't want to be near that. And I personally don't understand why it has to go somewhere like you're landing a spaceship in the middle of a neighborhood that was already there when I think there are other spots. And I haven't looked at this. And, you know, I know that you don't make the decision, but this is public comment. And I don't understand why someplace like Charles Street, where it's not going to affect anyone. It's not going to affect those homes over there. Again, it's not affecting me either place, but I don't think you should affect anyone when you don't have to. There's my comment. Thank you.
I have a question regarding the expenditure of the homes
that was appropriated by town meeting. Under whose discretion is that money spent?
That's on the point.
I believe that's, yeah. So you have the discretion to withhold spending money until we know more about pending issues?
The draft of town meeting,
excuse me?
Yes, town meeting authorizes the town manager to spend money, but does not ever force the town manager to spend
okay.
money. Right now we have two pieces of money, if you will, $50,000 from last year to hire an owner's project manager yep. to get introduced for that last night, and $150,000 to hire a designer. That money came available July 1st. So that's where we are on the project. And I just want to say one more time, it's something I said last night, the abutters that came in. This is one option. One of the problems in the past, if you look at some of our school projects, perhaps the library project, we did not do enough due diligence up front and cost estimating up front and impact estimating. So the fact that the neighbors have been showing up to three or four permanent building committee meetings already, well before any site decision has even been made, is a really good thing. This is the new way we're doing business with a permanent building committee. And they've been encouraged to attend, and they've spread word to their neighbors to that effect. So again, this is a data point that we hope to gather on one option. And as I said last night, I hope there's at least two more. One is a way to build it down at DPW. One is a way to move DPW and cemetery to a third location and put them together. Those are the three options I hope to ultimately present to town meeting. This is one of them.
Yes?
I appreciate this opportunity too, because aside from you hearing it, I'm not sure if any of my neighbors can hear it. We can discuss it later. But I'm just curious if families of those
resting in these cemeteries have been notified of this potential development
reason I ask is, I lost my mother a year ago, and my dad at 92 finds comfort. He goes to Forest Glen, which is buried. Today, I went, he sits under a tree, reads his paper, and says, I'm with Mom. Now, to be, if that were to happen at either of these cemeteries, to have trucks coming by, you know, this is a sacred place for many who find comfort in visiting loved ones. And to have, you know, a group of men having lunch or showers or, you know, trucks coming and go, it just doesn't feel or seem appropriate, whether it was in my backyard, which it is, or not. I think, even from that perspective, I do feel that people, families who have loved ones in these cemeteries should be aware of these conversations. Not everybody lives in Reading, not everybody gets the cash, not everybody, you know, is email connected. I don't know if there's a database, you know, of family members, but I would like to see those people contacted so they can also be heard as to how this could impact their lives.
I think that's not an unreasonable point. I think that should be passed along. And I think that's a fair comment to make. That's just one person speaking, but
I appreciate that.
One could certainly question the abutter rule there. I think that's... I think one of the things you've probably discovered over the course of the last couple of years is that we're encouraging, as a Board of Selectmen, this kind of open dialogue about all topics affecting the town. And we're going to continue to urge you to do that. You probably have seen us have open discussions among ourselves in front of you, you know, for that particular reason, because we think it's very important, instead of making a choice kind of in a vacuum, which is what I think Bob is referring to, is the Permanent Building Committee is... They really have, you know, no dog in that hunt. Their job, you know, as chartered by, you know, by the town meeting, is appointed in a separate way from the way other committees are appointed. It reports to town meeting, and its job is to be an objective analyzer of all of the facts, you know, regarding impact, cost, location, all of those kinds of things. So I'm going to encourage all of you who have this as a hot item on your topic of things that are important to you, I urge you to go to the next meeting on the 29th of August at Town Hall of the Permanent Building Committee and voice these very concerns. It's another place for the public to be heard. And at all of these public committee meetings, you should go as often as you can, particularly on topics that are of importance and interest to you. And then, by all means, all of you in this room elect town meeting members who decide how money gets spent and decide who's supposed to spend it and decide what they're supposed to spend it on. Let them know how you feel. It's really very important so that they can gauge their willingness to go forward or not on any given topic. So with that in mind, if you don't mind, I think we're going to move on to our agenda items unless someone has a burning desire for another public comment, which I'm happy to take if you have one. Okay, so let's move on to something really interesting, the MWRA infiltration and inflow. What do you think, Bob?
I think the shortest explanation would be best. Secretary should move as written. Someone should waive the further reading, and you should just approve it.
Yeah.
This is a 55-45% low interest grant loan program. Town meeting has authorized this. The Board of Selectmen is finishing off the authorization with a final vote.
Any discussion?
That's it.
Go for it, Barry.
Move that the sale of a $211,000, and somebody feel to jump in here. Sue bond of the town dated August 22nd, 2016, to the Massachusetts Water Resources.
Vice Chairman Sexton moves that we suspend the rest of the reading of that one. And Dan has a second. All those in favor?
Oh, we got to do roll call.
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Arena.
Yes.
Yes.
Barry.
Yes.
Dan.
Yes.
John Halsey, yes. Okay, so we have in front of us a motion. Move that the sale of the $211,000 sewer bond dated on such and such a date. And do we have a second?
Second.
You can't move in second, Barry.
Second.
Oh, that's right.
Okay, there we go, all right.
What did we just vote on?
What we're doing, what
to
we're
suspend
doing.
Suspend the reading.
We suspended the reading.
Should have just read it.
Okay. All right, all those in favor?
You gotta do a roll call.
Oh, roll call. John Arena?
Yes.
Kevin Sexton?
Yes.
Barry Berman?
Yes.
Dan Ensminger?
Yes.
John Halsey, yes. 5-0.
Thank you.
Get it right by the end of the year.
Sure. Okay. Now, let's open, I think, with a presentation, I think, Bob, that you have. I think that's probably the best way for us to proceed from here. And this is on the topic of senior tax relief and then ultimately tax classification.
Thank you. I'd like for the public to meet Vic Santaniello, our assessor. In the interest of frugality, we share him with Wakefield, although he does the best job for Reading, clearly. Victor will be here specifically to get into this, some of the tax implications. I want to start with just a broad introduction for both the public and the selectmen. Typically, tax classification happens in October or November once a year. There's a rather quick summary level presentation made, and the selectmen have four votes to take every year. I'm going to spend just a few more minutes going into a little bit more depth. Typically, at this October-November period, the classes of property are simplified into commercial, which represents commercial, industrial, personal property, and single-family homes, which is meant to represent residential. And each of those do represent 80 to 85% of their sector, so they're good proxies. But I want to spend a little bit more time. And I'm going to do it by looking at this horrific chart right here. This is FY16, FY11, and FY06 assessed data. So over a 10-year period with 3 years worth of data. And this just goes to show you at the top here, this is the residential class. It's approximated by that top number, single family. Over the 10 years, the amount of units has annual growth of 0.1%, not very much. And when you simplify it and only look at single families, you get one impression. But when you include condos, which we all know some of the big projects have been built, that's almost a 6% annual growth in the amount of units. So there's quite a different story that would be told, depending on how you look at it. Assessed value, 1.2% for single families. Since the unit growth is small, that's a pretty good ratio on a per house basis, if you will. 6.7% for condos. Well, we know there's a lot more units, so it's not surprising the assessed value of the sector went up by a larger amount. This is the market share. You can see 92.9, 90, 91.7. You know, Reading historically is approximated a 90-10 split in residential and commercial, industrial, personal property. And then these are some of the average values of the sector, which I really won't get into. But it just gives you a flavor that there's more to residential than just single-family homes. Down in commercial, industrial, and personal property, as you can see from these bottom sections, there's quite a bit more than just commercial property. And again, I won't go into this in a great deal of detail, but commercial has grown at a faster rate on a parcel basis than single-family homes, 1% instead of 0.1%. Their assessed value has over the 10 years, and the 10 years is really just picked randomly, gone up even faster than homes at 3.4%. But as I will get into, when you discuss averages in any sense in the commercial sector, it's a very dangerous thing to do because of the actual nature of the units. And again, we will get into that. The largest growing sector of property taxes, I dare say in most communities, certainly in Wakefield and Reading, is personal property. You can see down here a 9.5% annual rate of growth in assessed value from just under $16 million to just about $39 million in the most recent year. And you can see it's a fairly wide variety. Some of it is non-incorporated personal. Most of it is business and professional, and you can see some of the larger numbers, poles and wires, as telecommunications. So that just gives you a little bit more of a flavor that there's more to it when you talk about tax classification than just single-family homes and just commercial. I'm going to spend a little bit of time looking at commercial because I just mentioned briefly the averages are really a very poor proxy for the sector itself. Victor has divided up the commercial properties, and again, remember they're a section of commercial, industrial, personal property, into these six segments by assessed value. There's 84 properties below a half million out of the 200 total, 61 between half a million and a million, and so forth. You can see the property by amount of property, 70% are a million or less, 30% are above a million by parcel count. In terms of what taxes they pay as sectors, you can see that 23% are, you know, of the taxes are gathered from these lowest valued, and you know, over half is from the top two segments. And just as a way of highlighting these top two, these six parcels worth $10 million or more are all at Walker's Brook, and five out of the 12 that are classified between $3 and $10 million are at Walker's Brook. So let's just approximate and say half of the second largest one and the whole largest one is Walker's Brook. That'll be an important point to come back to. So again, if you look at these segments, they tell a very different story than looking at this bottom and just seeing an average, because the types of commercial properties are very different in town. I'll make a statement that is very broad, extremely broad, but I looked at all the data. Generally speaking, these lowest two classes are what you would consider to be small business, very roughly. The middle section, maybe the 1 to 2 million, and to some degree the 2 to 3 million, it's a variety of things, but it's often small business in a location where there's more than one small business. So the assessed value of a building might be $2 million. There might be four small businesses in that piece of property. And the two largest ones are big box, large. You know, you drive by, you know what they are. If you drove by, you could identify these 18s. There's just no question. So small business is, broadly speaking, the two lower segments, and then individually they make up some of this middle section, just as an overview. Again, a quick takeaway by assessed value, which someone should have labeled on this axis, namely me, the parcel count is very high for low assessed values, but the taxes paid by segments are obviously paid by the higher segments, the higher valued segments. One of the discussions that has happened in the community over the last, especially 5 years, both at the board level and in other meetings, has been a desire to grow the commercial sector and to diversify some of the reliance on single-family home property taxes. You remember what we look like now?
Yeah.
Let's just say our objective is to grow this sector by half, another 50%. Well, the simplest mathematical way is multiply every area by 50%. So suddenly, instead of having 206 parcels, we have 309, and we go from collecting $4.4 million in taxes up to $6.6 million in taxes. Great. So on paper, that's the simplest thing, but as anyone in the community would tell you, there is not the land to do that. There's just no chance that we can add half as many existing commercial businesses as are here already. So it's real clear to me, and I think to most people, that you're going to get growth at the high end by having a Walker's Brook 2. If, for instance, we were to double the $10 million properties and increase by half, 3 to 10 million, so there's again, that's more or less picking out Walker's Brook and duplicating it. We'll find another place to put it in town. That just about gets you your objective of growing the whole sector by 50%, and this is a much more realistic way that will happen. So at the end of the day, if this did happen, you'll notice the bottom four segments have not changed. The exact same businesses are there. They're all assessed at the same exact value. All of a sudden, the commercial sector is larger. They didn't change. None of them changed. Six parcels at the bottom and nine in the middle. 15 parcels changed, that's it, or 12 rather. So, you know, that's how most likely, the town will have commercial growth, and that's what we're working towards, certainly at the staff level. So at that point, I'm going to turn it over to Victor, and he's going to discuss some senior tax relief options, and then I'm going to also come in and talk about some of the senior tax options. So you want to start with that one?
Yes. Okay. Well, good evening. I've been tasked by both the Board of Selectmen and the town manager to take a look at what Reading could do in the form of additional tax relief for senior citizens in the town of Reading. We already employ the statutory exemptions allowed under law. And in some of the other motions we're looking at doing that we've discussed previously, we want to increase the amount of the senior exemption, decrease the interest rate on deferrals, adopt cost of living adjustments to those so we can raise both the income and asset guidelines as well as the amount we grant in an exemption. But in addition to that, I took a peek at two towns that have home rule petitions that where they came together to offer a different type of tax relief that currently doesn't exist under state law. Those two towns are Wayland and Sudbury. And in looking at both those communities, there were some attractive pieces of each type of exemption out there. But in trying to put together what collectively the assessors and myself would think to fit Reading, and also pass muster with the state legislature, because they will be the shepherding authority and approval authority of this home rule petition, I tried to take a good blended approach, the best of each. And one of the important things, and this will be my recommendation for the major qualifier to receive this type of tax relief should it pass, would be a senior circuit breaker credit. A senior circuit breaker credit is a refundable income tax credit for real estate taxes paid on residential property occupied as their principal residence. Eligible taxpayers may claim a credit equal to the amount by which their property tax payments in the current year, excluding any exemptions or abatements, and including water and sewer debt charges, exceed 10% of their total income in the same current year. For the purposes of the tax credit, a taxpayer's total income includes taxable income as well as exempt income such as Social Security, Treasury bills, and public pensions.
So I have Form CB from the state taxes. This is the tax form that someone would have to file and qualify under, Schedule CB rather.
Now, since we're looking at providing this tax relief to homeowners, there are other guidelines if you rent and meet certain income criteria to receive it off your income taxes. But since, you know, the assessors don't deal with income taxes, if you think you might qualify for that, please check it out on the state website. I'm keeping my comments to owners rather than renters. Now, who's eligible for the tax credit? Taxpayers must be 65 years of age or older before January 1st of the calendar year. For joint filers, only one taxpayer must meet the age requirement. Property must be owned and occupied as principal residence. And the income guidelines here are a lot more than what are on our traditional senior exemptions, which we're attempting to raise, but the income and asset guidelines are so low, we really don't have a lot of people in this community who qualify to receive those forms of tax relief. Thus, let's look at something a little bit different. But if you're single, you have an income up to $57,000. Married, up to $85,000. If you file head of household, $71,000. And your assessed real estate valuation does not exceed $693,000. Taxpayers who are eligible for the tax credit can claim it by submitting a completed Schedule CB, which Bob just showed you, circuit breaker credit with their state income tax return.
Victor, that threshold for real estate value is a fixed across the entire state?
Yes. Now, In looking at this again with the Board of Assessors, we examined Sudbury and Wayland, talked to the program administrators in both communities, and our last meeting and other discussions with the Board of Selectmen were quite spirited. We tried to figure out what the best model would be here for Reading. And I put forth that for a person to be considered for this form of tax relief, they must have received the Massachusetts Income Tax Circuit Breaker Credit last calendar year. Circuit Breaker Credit is income-based, so it is means-tested. Some people will qualify for the max credit, which was $1,070 last year. Other folks would get less. By using the Circuit Breaker as a qualifier, we're removing a great deal of subjectivity from the application process, along with uncertainty as to how much one might receive. It also provides for an outside source of verification from state-approved sources. So basically, we're taking our exemption and hinging it upon outside sources that are already proven by the state. State has its own mean-tested program vis-a-vis the Circuit Breaker, and we're relying on people's qualification for that in order to consider granting this form of tax relief. The other thing that we're recommending is domiciled in Reading for the past 10 years. You could have owner-occupied your home for the past 10 years, but we do have folks that have downsized and moved into the numerous condominium projects here in Reading and have chosen to keep Reading as their home. I think if we keep it to domiciled, folks that fit the criteria who have downsized would still be eligible for this type of exemption.
Victor?
Yes?
Does the term domicile imply ownership throughout that period?
Well, you have to own your property. That's a given.
For 10 years.
Well, you have to, you have to own your property.
Today.
But you have to have been domiciled in Reading.
So you could have lived in an apartment for 3 years and then in a house for the last seven, and that would qualify.
I think we could do whatever we want in that regard. These are just my suggestions. I would prefer a pattern of home ownership for 10 years, regardless of which home.
I just want to know if you're being precise.
Home ownership and residence. Right.
Yes. Yes, John.
Victor, on the question of the 10 years, I've been given to understand that that is actually fixed. It cannot exceed. Is that your understanding?
There are statutory exemptions. John did ask about the 10 years. Is that fixed? There are other statutory exemptions that require domiciled in Massachusetts, ownership in Massachusetts, and it's been my experience that none of them have called for anything beyond the 10-year mark.
But notwithstanding past precedent, is there a legal barrier to making that number different than 10?
None that I'm aware of.
Victor? Do we know how many people in Reading got the Circuit Breaker tax credit last year? And I know some of them might be renters, so it's going to be a skewed number, but that should be an easily obtainable number.
It's 643.
There you go.
From the latest details were from calendar year 2014. 2015 numbers aren't available yet for the state.
And we can assume that some of them were renters. So.
Yeah. I certainly hope so.
So on that, assuming that none of the demographics have changed, we should have, there'll be probably less than 642 people. Households.
In taking a peek at Wayland, since Wayland is one that uses the Circuit Breaker as kind of a baseline, they received about 50% of applicants for the form of local tax relief that received the Circuit Breaker program. So,
not everybody applied.
State income tax, Circuit Breaker, they had about 250 people qualify. They had about 125 qualify and receive the exemption locally. I don't know if that's a good one-to-one relationship, but it's the only yardstick I've got. And again, John, I'm unaware of any legal requirements that, fix it. It's just a personal recommendation that in dealing with statutory exemptions, I haven't seen any beyond 10 years.
Okay.
Do you think, Victor, if we extended that, we would run into regulatory challenges?
Well, in my opinion, I think that perhaps we would, only because we're trying to keep this somewhat in tune with other types of existing state criteria out there.
That have passed muster in the past.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, the way the exemption would work is other residential taxpayers would pay for this form of tax relief. It presents itself as a shift in only the residential tax rate. So, in order to just estimate some kind of numbers, I took roughly $1 million of the residential side of the ledger and shifted it within the residential side of the tax rate. And I used fiscal year 16, our last complete year of data, as the basis. And we all know that fiscal 16, our tax rate was $14.50. If we were to think that this type of tax relief would cost about $1 million, that would add about 25 cents to last year's tax rate. So instead of everyone paying $14.50, you'd be paying roughly $14.75, with the difference going to provide this type of special senior tax relief. But that's with $1 million cap.
Victor, just to clarify, that 25 cent increase in the tax rate would only go to the residential taxpayer. The commercial rate would remain the same. So without some type of mechanism, residential rates would be higher than commercial rates.
Yes.
Victor, can you explain a little bit of how the money flows in regards to the number of applicants? If 1 year goes from 150 to 250, what's the difference? You know, how's it kind of break down? If we're guesstimating what we're going to be spending and we're charging that to the taxpayer?
Let me continue.
All right.
I may answer all that and more.
Yeah.
But wait.
Some of the other recommendations we're making, the max circuit breaker credit is $1,070. The board feels that maybe we should grant a little bit more than that, perhaps a multiple of 1.5. So if you're a homeowner domiciled for 10 years in Reading, at a rate of 1.5, your exemption amount would be $1,605. Now, if 400 people qualified and they all received the max of $1,070, and we adopted a 1.5 times exemption amount, that would equal $642,000, well below the million. Plus, I think that at a rate of 1.5, if we could word the home rule petition accordingly, we could reserve a little bit more room to go up to 2 or have some other type of capping mechanism. But the way that I would devise the application process would be during the month of August. We would have an application to file. They would have to drop off some tax forms. The assessing staff would verify ownership and domicile rules. But by mid-September, we'll know exactly how much that cap is that we're going to reserve.
Okay.
So we just set aside $1 million, not knowing what path this would take us down.
Sure.
But we'll have a clear understanding going into subsequent classifications of exactly how much the shift on the residential rate would be.
Gotcha.
And would that give us the option when we do our tax planning in the later fall to adjust up or down the multiplying factor?
If it could be worded within the home rule petition, yes.
Okay, so that's something that we could, in the petition, give ourselves the flexibility to let that move appropriately.
That's my recommendation.
Kind of based on what we think is the right number.
Mm-hmm.
And so the flow of this is, when we write this home rule petition, do we write it with a capping mechanism as a dollar amount, or do we write it as a percentage Tell me how that works. Tell me how we choose that.
The way other home rule petitions have been written doesn't mean you can't create a new one. What you would state is a 1.5 to 2.0 range times the senior tax credit.
Right.
And then and silent on everything else. So the key with a home rule petition, as with most things, is you want to give yourself as much flexibility as possible. So there's no need to mention the $1 million. There's just, that's the mechanism. That allows this board, you know, the Board of Assessors to get together and decide where in that range do we want to be.
And, you know, part of that will be a function of, you know, as you talked about in future years, applications would be gathered. You'd have a deadline of, say, September 1st, just to pick a deadline. That would give the assessors the opportunity to review the amount of applications that qualify.
It would definitely allow us to, by mid-September, provide the Board of Selectmen with what we, with how many people apply, and then you can in turn decide, do we want to do 1.5, do we want to do 1.75, do we want to do 2?
Got it.
Okay. A quick question, Victor, just to back up. On the matter of the 2% increase, you described it as 25 cents. It might be useful in kind of truth in advertising here that we represent the burden at the either average house level or some other rolled-up metric. 25 cents kind of isn't the way people think of their taxes per thousand. The second question is, I see the capping mechanism as another tool as well as the fact that the capping mechanism gives us confidence rolling up the budget that we know the maximum burden that'll be put on the balance of the residential class. Within that cap, we have another lever, if we're oversubscribed, to bring it back. And they sound like they're similar purposes, but I think they're slightly different. One is a confidence in budgeting, and the other is a factor where off any given year you have a way to deal with an oversubscription or volatility year to year that you didn't anticipate. With the same comment regards the ratio multiplier in the home rule, is there a vehicle to have flexibility in the cap year to year if you chose to, just to allow you to do so without having to pass another home rule?
John, this is Bob. In the legislation, you wouldn't have a cap. You wouldn't have a dollar figure or a percent cap. You would only have that 1.5 to 2.0, and then you're kind of on your own.
And so the multiplier, John, is the 1,070. So the circuit breaker creates an income tax credit of 1,070.
Yes.
So a person qualifies for a circuit breaker credit. That is a separate credit which they maintain regardless of this credit.
Yes.
That's 1,070. So it's the baseline factor for the multiplier. So rather than pick a number of $1 million cap, $1.5 million cap, $750, what you simply do is you know already what you're multiplying by. Or what number you are multiplying. It's the number that the state is going to set, and they're going to, I'm assuming that number could change over
yes.
time.
Yes.
And probably has and probably will. Yeah, the 1,070 is going to be a fluid number.
Right.
So that being
the cap isn't a cap, it's more theoretical.
Correct.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, Victor, for purposes of discussion, said if we hit $1 million of usage,
right,
that X, Y, and Z would happen, that it would create a 25-cent hit to the tax, to the residential tax rate, and thereby creating an inverse split, actually, because in that situation, residential taxes would be at a higher rate than commercial property taxes if that was left to stand that way. Do I have that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, and to your other question, your first question, John Arena, as soon as Victor's done, I'll get into more data and tax information than you'll ever want to see.
This is fine. I now understand that the cap is purely a conversation yep. point and not a
right.
role that we have. That's great.
Yeah. Barry, you had a question?
I do think year by year, we really need to set how much money we're willing to shift into this program. If we're oversubscribed and people, and now the maximum benefit is it's now going to cost $2 million. That's going to create a much bigger shift in the tax rate. Whereas I would feel more comfortable maybe when we set the budget to say, okay, like we do with free cash. This year we're going to try to keep it at $1.5 million. We set a number, and if it's oversubscribed, people will get less. But I don't think that we should have that total dollar cap be a floating number. I think it needs to have a fixed period, and whether we change that from year to year, that's fine, but it needs to be reviewed. Maybe we don't put it in the home rule, but I just think for budgeting purposes and everything else, that we just need to have a fixed number we're willing to kind of shift out.
Well, I think that you satisfy that by the proper use of the multiplier. So we know what the baseline number is for criteria. We know that for this year, for example, it's $1,070. That's going to be a fluid number, without question. Now, I mean, is there anything that stops us from having a range of 1.0 to 2.0? So, for example, what you could then say is that in a year where we're oversubscribed, when it comes time for the Board of Selectmen, they would initiate their option to either use the multiplier for exemption at 1.0 or 2.0. So I think, first of all, in the home rule petition, from what I'm understanding, to peg a number is we're going to probably run afoul of the DOR and maybe our legislators themselves. But by understanding that at the moment we have 650 people, 643, right? Mm-hmm. Whatever that number was, it's right around there. That's the maximum number that qualified last. My guess is that that number is not going to grow substantially for several reasons. First of all, there are requirements as to who the 10-year requirement, for example, is going to enjoin somebody from saying, oh, let's go to Reading and buy a house because we're going to get an exemption. Well, first of all, if you look at the pricing, you may exceed the $693,000 assessed maximum. I mean, that's something that could happen to you. I mean, it seems like there's a lot of safeguards built into the back end of this thing.
Although, on the other hand, if this program gets adopted, people who might not have filled out the paperwork because I'll get a couple of bucks back from the state now know they're going to be able to get money from the state and from the town of Reading. You may see a lot of people. This is a generation, as we know, when Jane came in, they're not used to asking for things. So when we go and advertise this thing, and now people can get double kind of the benefit, I have a feeling that there's going to be a lot more people that are going to qualify, which is why I'm really worried about not having a dollar cap on it.
Victor, is there a way to forecast that, or is that we don't have that type of information?
We lack the technology.
Okay.
There are no comparisons I could make. The data exists. It's static. It can't be paired to population because you don't have accurate income reporting from population segments, too broad. But of the 640, and I stand corrected, two, the average circuit breaker amount granted was $800, I'll round it to $40. So because it is means tested, people do get less, people do receive the max.
So the closer you are to that income cap, the less you get.
Correct.
The more you're
right. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot, it seems to me, in my analysis of the various safeguards, and I'll call them safeguards for, you know, so the thing doesn't explode, you know, on the town and therefore the residential, at this moment, the residential taxpayer, you know, who doesn't qualify. You know, that whole idea of the sliding scale of qualification, that is the largest number they can get is at 1,070. And so it can, I think I understand this right, Victor, that could be $300 based on, you know, what you qualify for.
Oh, yeah, some folks can get a lot less.
Yep, Dan.
Just want to clear something up here. What is the form of the relief to the taxpayer? This is not an out-and-out credit. Coming back to this is a deferral. This is putting the taxes on their property as a lien. correct?
No.
No.
No, there's something else.
It comes off their taxes as a credit.
To credit off their real estate taxes.
Everybody. Okay.
The circuit breaker is a credit off their income taxes.
It's different from the other form of relief we were talking about.
Yes.
Yeah, that, yeah. This is, stands on its own. We've talked about some other things about deferral and interest rates and all those kinds of things, but this one is, as I understand it, is strictly a, if my taxes were $5,000 and I got a $1,000 credit, my taxes are now $4,000. Is that essentially true?
If we grant it at a factor of one, take the $1,070 off,
yes.
Victor, is one the less, the least that we can factor? Can you go to 0.5, 0.75 if you need to?
I would, to address your concerns, I would leave it as largest spread as you're comfortable with, quite honestly.
Okay.
If you
so it's whatever we set.
Exactly.
I think that satisfies your concern, Barry.
Yeah, I just want to know what the maximum cost is, as much as we can. And it's going to be hard the first few years because the word will get out on the program. Maybe more.
It's going to take 3 years, probably.
More people will, you know, find out about it. We'll get better at sort of figuring it out. But I would hate to have this thing go haywire in the first couple of years and catch us unprepared.
So it wouldn't be outrageous, Victor, to have a 0.5 to 2. And if you do that, every year when we are voting tax classifications, it sounds like that's what we would, one of the things we would consider.
And again, to stress, with an August application period, you'll know and you'll have plenty of time
plenty
in
of time,
advance.
Right.
Because we don't finalize that generally till November.
And this is really forecasting the worst case scenario, quite frankly. We're probably not going to come across that. We might, but we probably aren't.
Yep.
So the bigger issue is that you're never going to get surprised by the number of people. The risk is that folks have this set expectation because it's oversubscribed and you do have to throttle it back. And to Barry's point, although it's not in the legislation, I bet there probably should be, I don't want to call it a policy, but in the same way that we do the revolving funds and have a concept of where balances should be, you might have a policy along this that gives you at least some heads up for future boards as to what our thinking was, so that they know how to, you know, they can choose to ignore it if they want. There's some water line that they can observe.
Yep.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And I think if I'm correct, is this the program that the state is actually looking at as well too?
I have a statement in here that the DOR was most helpful facilitating responses to the technical questions I have. I am wholly unaware, not from a lack of trying, mind you, of anything that may be pending regarding expanded senior tax relief at the state level.
Okay.
This is based largely on my 20-plus years of experience of where I think things could end up from the state. And us trying to be somewhat compliant and as close to what they could possibly come through with.
Well, I think when you talk about that, Victor, the last thing we should get people accustomed to would be a credit that would somehow then be taken away through state statute. I would rather us, you know, let's see how it, my own opinion is, we need to I personally think we need to create this opportunity for seniors. I think we need to create flexibility in it at the same time, you know, so that as we know, I mean, if we have 500 people and, you know, we get some calculation based on your look at those applications, that that's going to be an average of $1,070. We have a pretty good idea of what that's going to cost to the question of caps, as long as we apply the correct factor. And if we give our, and you're telling me we can have a wide range of factoring here, you know, maybe a 0.5 to a 2.0. I'll be with you in just a second, okay? So is that, do I have that right?
One other point I'd like to get out. Other home rule petitions I've seen, usually good for about 3 years before they have to be resubmitted and reapproved by the legislature.
Okay.
So there is another vehicle to say, hey, this was a wildly successful program, let's keep it going, or boy, that Victor didn't know what he was talking about, and it's a complete failure.
Yeah. Are there other questions? John, do you have a question?
The first rule here in my mind is first do no harm. There's a lot here we can't know. It's not possible to know. And I bet this will take 2 or 3 years before we see see it come into full bloom in terms of steady state subscription rates. So to the extent the factor is our major level, I'm fine with it because it gives us a way to throttle it back if things go badly. Likewise, if things go and it's undersubscribed, you have a way to meter that up in the other direction. So I'm fine with it, but in all of this, I'd be looking to walk before I ran and give us a year or two to see how it plays out before we commit it in any hard sense of the word. I don't think we're doing that here tonight in any of the discussions so far.
So before, I know that there's some public interest in questions. Before I go there, any other questions from the board for Victor? Yes, Barry.
Victor, can you go back to the numbers where the income figures, qualifying figures were?
That's for the senior circuit breaker.
Senior circuit breaker, which is what we're going to basically peg our program to. When we first started talking about it, you know, I thought that what we were really trying to do was target the biggest benefit to, you know, folks who really had really severely low income, people whose property taxes as a percentage of their income were, you know, fairly high, and that basically living on a fixed income. Now, I understand the need to kind of have a program that's already in place and not reinvent the wheel and have us have to hire 10 people to figure out whether 400 are going to apply. So I understand the use of kind of using an already existing program. It makes life easier. But, you know, there's a lot of people in town that aren't seniors who make under, let's say, $85,000 a year that we're not helping in this. And I'm not saying that, you know, we don't have a mechanism to do that, whereas on the senior piece we do, because there's a state program. But those income figures are pretty high. And I would think that maybe somebody who makes $85,000 a year, you know, could probably,
As a joint income,
you know, might not be having as much time or hardship paying their property taxes as maybe somebody that's on $12,000 a year in Social Security. So, I mean, we're really opening it up to a really large segment of people, which is great, and we want to be helpful, and I think we've really done a lot of work in trying to mitigate the impact of rising taxes, especially when we have the override discussion, to folks who have an inability to keep up with that. But I was a little surprised when I saw the qualifying numbers.
Well, I will say that, you know, they are qualifying numbers. We have to remember, as a homeowner, your taxes and your water and sewer, what have you, exceed 10% of your total income. So by definition, the senior circuit breaker income tax credit is means tested. So the person at the high end isn't receiving the maximum benefit, which was in the wheelhouse of what we wanted to do. Sudbury was very attractive, but for, you know, the concerns of putting people at risk with unpredictability as to how many people, the labor costs associated, and the subjectivity locally on it. So
no, I get that it's, you know, we don't want to create a program.
I think we can't lose sight of one other very important fact. So if you have, let's say you have a single person that's earning a minimal Social Security income, and that is their whole source, okay? And that's let's pick a number and say it's $15,000, and their home, you know, which they bought 50 years ago, cost them $12,000. But today, their property taxes are six. So it's kind of like half their income. So I get, and I think all of us realize that there's all kinds of alarms that go on around that. Now, and Victor, you're going to have to correct me where I'm wrong about this, but that person that I just described would likely be receiving the maximum credit with the maximum multiplier. A person that is a couple who are earning $80,000, whose costs of taxes and debt on the water and sewer exceeds $8,500. Okay, yeah, they qualify, but they're not going to qualify. I don't know how it slides, but...
I don't believe they'll qualify for the larger amount of the exemption because it's income-based.
Correct.
And it's also tied into the percentage they pay of their income.
Right. So it really, I think, addresses the issue. You look at that number, and I hear what you're saying. You know, you have a young couple that, you know, is making that, and they're making ends meet, and they found a way to... So why are they different? But they are different in this regard that, you know, if that's where you are, you might, if you were a senior, qualify for a very small amount. If you weren't 65, you wouldn't qualify for any amount. But if you were the senior that had the very low income that you talked about, now you start to have some material, you know, savings that go on to their taxes. It turns into a multiplier on the $1,070 income tax credit that they're already getting. So in that scenario, if you have that person, they're paying, if they're making that kind of money, they're paying no federal income tax. Any they would be paying would come back in the way of credit. And then you look at their real estate, and if you have a 1.5 multiplier, now they have another $1,600 that, so it becomes material to the person it needs to be material to. I think that's the way. Yes, Bob.
To some of the comments, especially made by John Arena earlier, I think walking before running is a really important concept here. Victor can't tell you what's going on at the state level, but I can, and not because he doesn't know, because it's different channels. In March, I talked to one of our state elected officials and asked him, you know, is there interest in this topic? He said it's huge. I know from my fellow town managers, this is not a unique thing in Reading. We're all watching to see what Reading does now, because Wayland and Sudbury were very different the way they put it together, and we're kind of taking the best of both. When Sudbury applied last June 30th to extend their home rule petition to be forever, the DOR said no, 3-year maximum. So all the signs to me are that at some point the state is going to step in and say, okay, we've heard from so many communities, we can't have 350 home rule petitions. We have to step in and we have to be the state. We'll tell you what to do. So I think it's really very prudent of the board to be careful about how much tax relief is offered at the beginning stages, because although it's obviously better than the current situation, it would be a horrific thing for a senior in 3 years to lose half of the benefit that Reading had offered because the state said no. So I think it's really important that the selectmen take a cautious approach, as most of you have mentioned. And although nothing is formally in the works, the fact that Sudbury was not granted an exemption for more than 3 years tells me it's discussion. And I know among other town managers in this area, it's a lot of discussion. Every town has the same situation just about.
So before I open the floor for questions from the public, anything else from the board? Way questions for Victor or about anything you've read or think you've read?
John,
sometimes. The only other thing, John, would be the philosophical point to Barry's comment is if we're aiming this primarily at one, seniors, two, that have lived in their house, three, that have resided there for 10 years, that's a, and it's qualified by the state circuit breaker, that's a nice way to describe the segment that we're focused on.
Yep.
And it's a way that uses the state qualifiers to keep us out of the business of trying to figure out where folks are in terms of income, et cetera.
And John, I think you've summarized that well. I think that is the discussions that we've had now for over a year, that addresses the target group that we're most concerned about. So.
But where I'm going with this is if this broadens to a discussion on graduated taxes in general, I don't think that's the focus of this discussion at all. I'm not sure I heard that properly because of the phone connection, but this really, in my mind, has always been aimed at supporting seniors. We did that with the adjacent apartments. You know, now we're talking about doing it in a more economic way.
Yep.
But I don't view this as a segue into anything beyond helping seniors in terms of taxation.
Well, that is strictly the topic on the table. You're correct.
John, if I might.
Yes, Bob.
Just before you ask for a public comment, let me just put a few numbers out there. If you look at the bottom table, John Arena, this is you can see it, page TC6.
Yes.
The relevant column is 1.00 next to residential, right here. These are various assessed value single-family homes, and this would be the cost of $1 million shift from senior tax relief. So again, we've discussed maybe we don't see the full million in the first year, but if you did and everything else stays the same, this is the impact on single-family homes, just for a start.
$125 per year for a $500,000 home, is that what that number
That's
is?
Correct.
That is correct.
Thank you.
Yes, Elaine, you have had your hand up the longest.
Okay, I definitely have a question about this, but I just want to go back to just make sure that I understand what you're talking about with regard to being able to, the Board of Selectmen on an annual basis would sort of have the knowledge of the number of applications for the relief. You would go into a process of setting this ratio or multiplier anywhere between 0.5 and 2.
That's a suggestion I put out there, yeah.
But is $1 million the goal? This is what my concern, and I think it's been talked about, is just trying to understand. So if, let's just say you start out next year with the goal to provide $1 million of relief, and that means that the multiplier is 1.5 that you got there. And then the next year there's more applications. So, but you're really trying hard to keep the 1.5 for, you know, to provide the relief that basically you gave last year to people. But that would mean that the number total is 1.3 million cost. So.
Well, first of all, just so you understand, the $1 million, you almost have to take that off the table.
Okay.
That's part of the story. That's a discussion point. That's not a $1 million number.
Okay.
It's $1 million. If this many applications happened and it cost you $1 million, this is what it's going to cost. The idea instead is, I think, and it's part of the discussion we had here, is when the applications come in and we understand how many are approved at what percentage level, okay? So there's so many that qualified at 80,000, so many qualified at 15,000. It's going to give us an indicator of what the cost would be at a variety of different multipliers. And at that point, you know, to the point that I think Barry brought up, and I think it's a good one, you have to look at the town budget. And if the town budget says that, you know, this is, or the tax budget, not the town budget, the tax budget says this is what it's going to do, if all of a sudden the implication on a $700,000 appraised home that was going to cost you $175, if it looks like that number is going to jump exponentially, then the Board of Selectmen are going to have to say, yeah, we really have to keep that multiplier here so that... It's a question of balance and parity is really what it is. To try to, the goal is to protect those that need the most protection, you know, really.
So just to that point, I just buried was the other slide that showed what the income qualifications were.
Yeah.
I sort of just did average home, some numbers. Like, in order to be qualified for that, I would have to pay 3 times the taxes. So the burden, if you look at this income number, the 85,000 on married, that's 12% of their income is going to pay the property tax. I'm just sort of like, I just trying to understand, well, what does that really mean? What's my own burden now? And I have to be 3 times what it is now for me. So.
It's water and sewer. It's water and sewer added in as well.
It's water and sewer debt, right?
Water and sewer
debt. It doesn't apply.
Not water and sewer.
Oh, the debt, okay.
Water and sewer debt.
Gotcha.
So a portion of your bill is tied to debt.
Well, specifically in Winchester, they have water and sewer debt, water debt, on the tax rate.
Okay.
We do not have any water or sewer debt on the tax rate, so it technically is irrelevant.
Right.
I was just trying to say that well-qualified people.
I think the eliminators and the qualifiers have been very, very well thought through, and for us to try to attack them, I think people certainly above my, you know, accounting pay grade have done some, or, you know, actuarial pay grade have thought this through. And I think that the... yes, ma'am.
Yes, I have a couple of questions. I understand that the point of this is trying to...
Could you identify yourself?
Tina Brzezinski, 60 Paris Park. So one of the questions I have, so what I'm trying to understand, so you're trying to take an existing program and use those parameters for this program for the town of Reading?
Well, what we've done is there are two such programs that exist in the state. And what Victor has done at our request is try to analyze those and pull out the best of both and build a hybrid that he thought would be something we should consider. And that's what you're seeing up here, is a hybrid of...
Wayland and Sudbury.
Yeah, there are two such places.
Okay, so it's a hybrid. And then I have a couple of points I wanted to ask or just to bring up. So one is the age determination is 65. Generally, the retirement age is being raised to 68 now. So that's my first question is, how is it 65, which is 68?
I can answer that for you. We're actually looking to use what the state has already created as a qualifier tied to the circuit breaker. The state has made that decision. That's currently what, you know, what their qualifying criteria are. And so for us to reinvent that is probably ill-advised. It will cost us actuarial work. It'll cost us staff. We can use what exists, and what exists is 65.
So is it the same for those income levels?
That's same thing.
Greater?
Yep.
Okay, because there are also many other state programs, such as when you're applying for 40B. So 40B, they base it on, you know, 70 or 80% of the median income in the area. Yep. So the household per capita median income for Reading is about $105,000, or a single person household. So, but I know for mass housing or for 40B projects, to qualify for it, you need to make $50,000 for a single person household. And say 56,000.
There are so many different things. Depending on, pick a day, there's a different program in the state that is tied to some kind of a distribution or redistribution of money. Now, all of them have individual qualifications. The one that seemed to make the most sense to us, and based on the recommendation of the assessor, and I agree with this, is you pick the one that most closely resembles the housing situation, and the circuit breaker is such a program. Now, it designs its tax credits off your income taxes, but it builds the criteria. So we can invent, you know, a little better mousetrap looking at two programs that have currently existed. But for us to embark on the idea of doing an actuarial study about what fits best in Reading probably will cause us to spend time, money, and staff that probably is not going to get us much closer than, you know, what we have to work with. So I believe that that's the reason we're considering it this way.
Okay, so my next question then is, you know, you're talking about projections and the annual increases. The town has the census data for the ages of everyone in town. So
yes.
Can't a prediction be made based upon, you know, there's X amount of people who are 65, will be becoming 65 the next year and the next year?
The problem, as I explained earlier, is the way the state has their circuit breaker information available, all that I can find is the total number of people in Reading that received a circuit breaker, which was 642, and the average amount, which was $840. It doesn't break that down by how old the people were. Also, renters are included in that, so it doesn't parse out the rental information. So I could find no way to correlate that with existing census data. Believe me, I tried.
Okay, so then my next question is...
Okay, so everybody gets four questions. This is it, go ahead. Come on, give us the next one.
I'm trying to just calibrate all of this from the perspective of, okay, so if these people are making $85,000, the median income is $105,000, right? So
everyone who else makes parking 20,000 more are now subsidizing, but then you're also putting the burden on commercial who draw the least. No, so this is not adding.
Well, the way this
we're talking about this alone.
Right.
That's the next item of discussion.
That is a related item, but a separate topic for discussion.
Okay. So then the idea is that people who make an average 20,000 more will be subsidized and people who make 20,000 less than them?
It's conceivable that that could happen.
Well,
it is conceivable, yes.
That was right there.
However, let's take a look at the person that makes $85,000, the person that makes $84,000. Okay? Because if you make $85,000, you're essentially going to qualify for zero. I mean, you're at the top of it, so you're going to get the minimum amount of subsidy. So the cost pass-through is not $1,000. It's a small number. I don't know what the minimum is, Victor. Do you know what it is?
Minimum to qualify?
No, the minimum
benefit. They
benefit.
Don't tell you.
I don't know.
We know that the average in Reading is 800. So the average doesn't qualify at the maximum. That's just for openers.
John, I think what Tina's asking, correct me if I'm wrong, it's not people who make 100,000 that are subsidizing. It's basically all of the residential taxpayers, as this stands right now, are subsidizing the people.
So
that's
someone who's making 40,000
okay.
Helping to pay the taxes if someone makes 84,000.
Okay, so let's stop and think about that for a second, okay? Let's just think in a practical way for a minute. If I'm making it as a joint income $105,000, what is the probable appraised value of my home?
But you don't know that.
But of course I don't know that. But here's what I do know. I know that if I'm making $105,000, which is your argument, that I qualify for a home that, pick it, is it $400,000? And is the appraised value, the cost pass-through on that is somewhere around $50.
There's a major
count. We can roll around in the mud on this all day long. What we're looking about.
You can't spend more than 30% of your income on your house.
That's correct.
Some of this stuff is. I'm just trying to understand. So you're still asking someone who may be having financial struggles, making $40,000 a year, to help subsidize someone who's potentially making $84,000.
Is a person that's making $40,000 a year going to own a home and ready? Is the next question.
They might
if they've owned it for a long time.
But the thing, my question is, so that person is having that year and they're unemployed, mm-hmm. right, they still have their property tax.
That is correct.
So they're still helping to subsidize someone who's much better off than them. Is that fair? So I understand that we have a population that is in need. I just don't believe that population in need makes 84,000 people. And I'm trying to suggest that maybe there's a way to find. And I don't know what the answer is. I'm just putting myself in discussion. I'm just trying to understand how do you discern who that is, and I assume you would use a program in place, a circuit breaker. But this just doesn't seem fair to me, because there are plenty of other people who were really hurt during the recession and who still haven't recovered. And you know what? That $125 that they're now contributing to a different family, well, you're taking away their right to choose how they're spending that money. And I don't know if that's the right thing to be done. And the goal is wonderful, but I just...
Hey, John, can I jump in here?
Sure, you can jump in.
So I think this gets back to the point about focusing on the segment, because what... And I'm sorry, is Tina speaking?
Yeah, Tina.
She's going to a different group with a different set of concerns, and that's exactly why I think in bold letters at the top of the page, you have to state this is aimed at seniors that have been in their house over 10 years to qualify for the circuit breaker, full stop. And we intentionally focused on that just for ease of administration, yep. and the avoidance of having to do separate qualifiers and address the other segments. We're not big enough or smart enough to do much more than this. And if you don't do that, I fear that you end up with a slippery slope of, well, what about this other demographic? What about this other segment? We're not saying anything other than folks who've lived in their house and resided in the town for over 10 years qualify for the circuit breaker, full stop. That yep. doesn't cover many people. We know it doesn't, but it's easy to administer. Good should not be the enemy of great here.
Yep.
I think, Mr. Brown, another important point, John, is that
As one who has collected the maximum circuit breaker for the last several years since the fire passed away, I'm looking at perhaps $1,605 coming back to me at maximum.
Mm-hmm.
I have a two-bedroom home. It could be converted back to a three-bedroom home very easily. If you had three children in that home, that's more than that $1,605.
It's $39,000.
That's right. So
just as a, yeah. But who's counting?
I believe I'm not in about a year and a half anyways, because I'll make my 50 years so, $1,605, I believe, have a nice, I also be torn down the four-bedroom house.
Yeah.
So you're going to...
It's an interesting point, Bill.
Which is exactly what we're trying to prevent, because if people can't afford to stay in their houses, what they're going to basically sell to a developer or somebody else who's going to buy up a lot, and they're going to put up a three- or a four-bedroom house, and, you know, you're gone. So
I'm in a different place, Barry. If somebody in mid-career has a tough year, it happens. We're not here to solve that problem. We're here to solve people that are principally retired or accustomed.
Yes, correct. I mean, the criteria for what we're trying to accomplish is pretty clear. Yes, Bob.
I think a really important point to bring up here is we have to be really careful about stepping on the state's toes on this. The state sets a lot of this social policy. They don't want municipalities doing it. We have two models, Sudbury and Wayland, and we have copied them to some degree. So we know that they have passed muster with the DOR for this demographic and for this intention. I would have no assurance at all that if we strayed from this purpose, we can pass a home rule petition by the state. We can do this as a first step. I have no belief at all that we could easily start doing other things, and the DOR would say, you don't have the right to mess around with tax policy to that degree. So we've worked with our colleagues at the state level to put something together that we have a very strong opinion will pass through both houses, the state, House and the Senate, and get the governor's signature, which means the DOR has to bless it. Those are not easy hurdles when you start talking about tax policy. That is something the state has a very strong grip on. So I just caution you about getting too creative. This is, again, a very narrow target for the very purposeful reason. And I don't remember whether it was Sudbury or Wayland that was first, but they were very courageous to take it on. No one thought they'd actually get it passed.
So you had a question. You've been...
So if it's going to cost me $125. I'm sorry, my name is Mike Martin. I'm hesitant to even say anything for $125 that it's going to cost me, but as a matter of principle, I agree with that woman back there. I think it's unfair to provide a financial benefit to certain segments of society based on anything at this age at the cost of somebody else's younger. I think, for example, if you have one family, a married couple with three or four kids, and they had a bad year, and one of them lost their job and they're making $70,000 a year, so living on one income, and they're living in a $693,000 house. But they've got three kids that trying to go through school. They have higher costs than another couple who's in a similar situation, but their kids have grown up, their kids have moved out of school, they have no real expenses similar to the younger couple, but they have a $693,000 house that's probably got tons of equity in it. They're in a better position, I would argue, to pay their bills because they have all that equity in the house that they can tap into, compared to the younger couple that they don't have that equity in the house to tap into. They don't have that resource. It seems unfair to me. Just based on age, well, I feel like it's discriminating against younger couples with many kids.
Okay. Angela?
Angela Benda, Orchard Park Drive. I have a couple of questions about this. What was put out by the town, it says a million or more of tax relief to seniors that own property in town and have limited income. And I kind of agree with the other speakers that when I was thinking about that, I don't know that I would necessarily have thought of a couple 65 years old, $85,000. I don't know that I necessarily would consider that limited income, especially when you're thinking about younger people trying to move in. I'm also, I am in favor of this with hesitation because
I think that there are a bunch of moving parts, and the moving parts are the senior tax credit, the split tax rate, and the override. And I think it's really hard to think of one without discussing the other and without knowing what order they're being voted upon and what order they're being discussed. And I really...
Can I stop you for 1 second, Angela,
yes.
Just for purposes of understanding? All of the things you talk about are things that are being, that the town faces, along with many others. However, for purposes of this discussion and this comment, we're going to stick strictly to the senior tax relief, and then we will take up the other issues that are on your agenda because they happen to be on our agenda as well.
But my point is that I can't make a decision about whether or not I'm in favor of this without knowing what the others are and how they play into it. So my feelings about this...
Well, the beauty is you don't have to tonight. You don't have to until it gets in front of town meeting.
I'm allowed to just voice my opinion.
Certainly.
And I really don't think that I'm outside of the bounds of discussion with what I'm saying.
Well, we'll see. Go ahead. Please, go ahead. Yes.
Michael Giacalani, Winter Park Drive. My first question was the impact on the big average homeowner. I know we're throwing $125 number out there, but that's, I think, an expectation at a top level. Do we have that number for the average homeowner here in Reading?
That $125 is for about the average value. The average value is actually $499,500.
Now, to echo what some of the other people have said already, I think this is one of those things, death by a thousand lashes, because we're going to have this program here, and you say, okay, it's only $125. What's the big deal? And to it's, I think, unfair, and you're unable to make that assessment on people because, as has been said with variety of other comments, everybody's home is different. I don't care if you're making $100,000.
Yep.
I don't care if you're making $150,000. I don't care what kind of home you're living in. Everybody's situation is different. You can't make that assessment on somebody that it's fair for them to put this extra money in, because now there'll be an override that might come up, there'll be another issue that might come up, and every time you turn around, it's $100, it's $100, it's $100. In addition to that, I'm already paying into a state tax program, which is going into the circuit breaker credit. Now you're double dipping into my tax pocket by having me subsidize to the same person the same thing. And you're going to say to me, well, now you have to do this again with your tax dollars. So you just added to my tax burden onto something that's already in existence that I'm already paying into. And where this leads me in this whole thought process is that you're going to say, okay, you're going to reduce someone's real estate taxes now. Now, to someone who may qualify for this issue, they may or may not, you don't know, be itemizing on their federal tax return, and if you reduce their real estate taxes, you may reduce their itemized deductions to the point where now they are going to be doing a standard deduction instead of a higher deduction. They may be losing tax dollars on the federal side. And to back up what Angela just said to all these other things, somehow, some way, I think putting this program is going to be a backdoor into pushing for a tax shift against the commercial people.
Can Victor?
The existing form of tax relief in Reading, and it's standard in all other communities, although the qualifying criteria might be a little bit different, is a statutory exemption for senior citizens. In the few years I've been here, on average, less than 25 people per year qualify. If they're single, their income cannot exceed $20,000. And their assets can exceed $40,000. Many times we've had to deny folks that come to our counter with $15,000 in income who are penalized because they have a $50,000 CD in the bank. They do not qualify. In Wakefield, where I'm also the director of assessments, we have on average 80 people a year because we've taken steps many years ago to increase those income and asset limits and increase the amount of the exemption.
hopefully with the other questions that we put together, raising the COLA limits and other that, years down the road, we will have those up so that more folks can qualify. But the current guidelines, for example, I'm not defending this or what have you, I was simply asked to put together, what do you think might be a decent plan? And I think in context of discussions, let it be sequential. Let's get an understanding and answer questions about this, then whatever pieces come down the road, we can answer if there's a, you know?
To Berman's point, if you put a program like this in place, you're gonna find a lot more people that are gonna be applying for this than maybe we're gonna apply otherwise.
You may be right, and that's the reason we have that flexibility in the factory.
And you're gonna be asking the homeowners to kick in a lot more money to satisfy this program. And I think that's—
that gets back to the principle of what should the limit be for any aggregate benefit.
Well, and you know, I think we've talked about that with regard to the multiplier. I mean, that is going to be the thing that's going to allow us, once the first year goes by, to make a decision what the multiplier will be, tied to a dollar amount that we think is manageable. So, another question? Yes.
Michelle Sampson, 75 Columbia Circle. I was wondering, at the state level, and then you were talking about coming to Reading and 25 people because they have a $15,000 CD. Are assets separate, or do assets get looked at in this process as well?
The senior circuit breaker is an income tax-based credit. So assets, as far as I know, I'm not a certified tax preparer. So I do not know everything that they would consider, but as far as I know, it's income based, it's the value of the asset based, and the percentage that you pay for local charges, taxes, water and sewer and such.
So the value of the asset,
the house,
is
the house.
Thank you.
Yep. Yep.
Along the same thing.
Need to identify yourself.
As a senior, you tend to—
you need to identify yourself.
Oh, I'm sorry. Julie Thurlow.
I know, Julie.
From Reading and Walker Bank, so maybe you can too. The couple questions I did have, Barry had mentioned the 85,000, whether or not that limit was rather high. The Department of Housing and Community Development has tables that identify what they deem to be low to moderate income households, which might be helpful for this exercise because it would align with the state, because I know you were concerned about that. And on the other front, I think an asset test really would be necessary because as a senior, you manage your assets. You could have $500,000 in your 401k and manage to take only what you need for the year and then qualify under a program with an $85,000 target like that.
Mm-hmm. It's true. Yes, Mark?
Mark Oxford, 110 Beaver Road. I think this is an important concept. I think it's good to discuss and need more discussion. I'm wondering, in the state guidelines, that number 1070, I hesitate to ask why the state creates a number, but is there some reasoning or thinking behind that number?
I don't know. I know it can change from year to year. Previous years, it was 1,030.
Yeah.
I'm sure it's tied into some type of economic index. I didn't go into how much the state grants, because it's been a long-standing state program where they, you know, derive an amount, and that's what I based everything on.
Not something behind, not the changes, but just in the first instance, why they created that, if it relates to some average income or—
quite possibly, I don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Carol Sheck, Hensley Street. I'm kind of at a loss because I am a senior, and I'm shocked. It doesn't sound like that you disagree with what she presented, that there are pensions as well. And it's not that they are to take. Sir, I'm sorry, I'm going to point my question. I know you didn't mean that. It was a principle, right?
Well, it's coupled with everything.
Yeah, well, I understand that. I mean, we all live in that crazy society. And a few weeks ago, when we had a meeting here, Bob and I think the board is trying to do the right thing. It doesn't mean it's going to be a perfect thing, and you're helping direct it. But the bottom line is, we opened a meeting, and the first person that spoke said, I'm going to lose my house. And it was a man in a wheelchair. And I think it's all evolved where I agree with you, I have to stand up. I agree with you. You are right. I think a lot of people have, and you too, what you're challenging. But we have to do the right thing.
Sure.
If we have a percentage in our society, and I'm not, they're not asking for a lot, then you need to either work with the board and come up with an idea of what's going to happen to the vet who's in a wheelchair, what's going to happen to the young, the woman that spoke to Bob, too, in the back and raised her head at the end of the meeting because she was embarrassed to say she, too, was going to lose her home. I mean, it's not, I understand. I'm frustrated, too. I'm frustrated with government, much higher than town government. But you're the people here that can change it, so you have to make a decision. I'm kind of angry at you, too, but I'm trying to suck it in. You need to do the right thing. If you feel that it's not right, then you will vote no. And if you do feel, you can see where there are people in our town in need. I'm keep looking at you, and it's not because it's you. Then you have to vote no, and you will vote no. Are you a speaker? But they're trying to do the right thing. It's as simple as that. It's not anything that was right or wrong. There's no right or wrong answer here.
Yes, sir. Can I jump in just to kind of maybe put a lot of these comments together? A lot of times when we look at, you know, government programs, we think, oh, this is a really great idea. And then a couple of years later, you have, well, these are the unintended consequences of what happened. This was a different kind of process in that what really drove this discussion was the impending override discussion, which we've been talking about for a couple of years. And so as we talked about it, we looked at this as sort of an unintended opportunity. Here's a chance for our town to kind of state its values, that we believe that we're a town that people can age in place, that while all of us have gotten rich by going to bed every night, when we bought our houses 20 years ago for $250,000 or $300,000, and you know, no financial genius me, my house is $800,000, and I didn't do anything, right? So it's just by the luck of the draw. There are those, and I'm working. I can afford to pay those taxes. And so what we see in other towns is that, and I think, you know, what Bill was talking about, you know, if he sells his house because he can't afford to pay his taxes, a developer's going to come in and build another big house that is just going to increase the value, and it's going to be harder and harder for people who really built this town to stay in this town. That's what drove our thinking about, let's try to put a program together. Now, if we were starting at ground zero and we were just the first ones doing it and had a whiteboard, I would make the qualifying criteria maybe a little bit different. I would put an asset test in there, like Julie said, because there are a lot of people who work really hard and put a 401k and they're taking a little bit. But if you look at the qualifying thing, they look at their adjusted gross income and they're going to qualify. Those people could potentially afford to pay the taxes. I would look at maybe the income figures. I would look at some other things. However, what Bob said is that we're not going to have the opportunity to create our own sort of whiteboard program. We're going to have to kind of take the best and easiest thing that we can put in a home rule petition that the state is going to do. And it's not going to have an asset test in it per se. The income qualifications may be higher than what I would like. But generally, it's going to capture the benefit is going to come to the people who we really want to see it. It's not going to be perfect. But what it's going to be is that by supporting a program like this, we're saying as a community, we value the seniors in our town. We value the work that they did to help make this town what it is today. And we want to do our damnedest to try to keep them in town. And it's going to cost us $1 million a year. Is that a right thing to do? You know, before you talk about anything else, before about the override or anything else, as a town, is that the right thing to do? We think it is. How it all comes in, who pays for it, all that, that's another discussion where there might not be as much of agreement. But if you can say, I think this is something that we should endeavor to try, right, and it's not going to be perfect, let's do it. We're going to be the third town in the Commonwealth that does it, right? So the first person that does it, they go, they're wackos. The second person that does it, it goes, they're another wacko. The third person that does it, well, that's a movement, right? And so if we're successful in this, there'll be other towns that do it, and maybe the state kind of realizes it, and then we have a program. But the choice is that we're going to have an override discussion, right? More than likely, an override is going to be put on the ballot. And people will vote that up or will vote that down. And without some type of relief, you know, all homeowners are going to pay. It's going to hit seniors more. Here's a chance to kind of help out a little bit. So that's the framework of this discussion. It's not perfect, but it's something that we can do. And, you know, ultimately town meeting, I think, is going to be the one that decides whether or not this is goes forward to the legislature.
Yep.
But that's how I think we should kind of frame the discussion. And that's what this the whole override thing created the opportunity for us. I don't think we would have come up with this on our own.
I don't know if I agree with that. I mean, we are taking certain steps because we know that as the values, the residential values have gone up and the property taxes have gone up, and we have a substantial amount of people that live here, at least this is, I can only speak for myself. I know that there are a lot of people who have lived here 20, 30, 50 years, and they have paid a very small amount of money for their home originally. And yes, their home is worth a lot more, but there's another thing that's important to them, and that is to live in that home. I mean, to be honest with you, I expect to go out of my house with a tag on my toe. I want to live there. I like it in this town. I like the house I live in. And kind of that's where I want to, you know, that's where I want to age. And I think that there are a lot of people younger than me or older than me or the same age as me that probably feel the same way about this town, that this is a place they like to live. And so as we see the evolvement of this property tax growing, cost of government growing, granted, the value of that same senior I talked about's home has gone up, but honestly, they, in my opinion, we should be doing, we should be talking about this, we should be talking about the other three measures we're looking at for seniors on a standalone basis. I don't think it should be tied to, oh, if the override passes, you get this, if it doesn't pass, you don't. To me, they are mutually exclusive. This is something that is, to quote you, I believe the right thing to do. I think at a certain point you have to stand up and say, what is the right thing to do? I mean, there is equal and there is equitable. And you know, sometimes things can't be equal, but they can be equitable, they can be fair. It is the right thing to do. So I think from that perspective, this discussion about the senior credit, the home rule, I mean, it probably, Barry, to your point, has fostered more active discussion because of the financial circumstances of the town. I give you that. But I think this is a standalone item. I mean, this whole discussion is a standalone item. Yes.
I don't necessarily believe they're separate items because it all is going to weigh into the same tax bill. But I will say, I think it's the right goal, it's the right value of the town. We might keep an appropriate distribution of age in this town, and I think supporting the seniors is the right population to support right now. And in reality, especially at local level, the seniors cost the town a lot less than a family with four children. So for that reason also, we want to keep a good ratio of different ages. It's healthy for our town, and again, the reality is, if you get so many young families in, it's very costly for the town, because we all know what our local budget is, education, that's what we end up paying for. So I think it's important to keep appropriate ratio and supporting the seniors like this is appropriate. You can't help but to look at some of the circuit breaker stuff, but you've got to use a program that's already out there and have trust that that program is a good measure for people in need. I also think to go through those details, you have to consider the other things in front of us now.
I don't disagree that in an orderly fashion, you look at each one of these things, because at some point, voters need to understand each one of the components in a separate way, and then understand what that all means to them. And then they make a decision. And I really do agree with that, but I can tell you that if we try to drag every piece of that just as the chair of this meeting, we will all be here till 3 o'clock in the morning if we try to, and we will never make, exactly. So that's kind of my point in trying to keep these. Yeah, because, and honestly, Paul, I think that voters are going to need all of these component pieces and then they're going to need them laid out, and if they have a house that's worth X amount of dollars, what does this whole thing cost me? And then they decide. They decide what they want to vote for or against. And I think it's our job to, you know, to put all of these pieces out, get something accomplished, let people then understand what it means to them, and then whatever they decide is, it's our job then, you know, to deal with it. Our job and the school committee's job and the library trustee's job, it's our job to deal with the will of the voter, if you will. You had a question?
Yes. Jennifer Hillary, High Street. I'm curious how Wayland and Sudbury deal with the predictability factor in the sense of if the goal of the Board of Selectmen was to keep this $125 burden on a $500,000 residential household, how have Wayland and Sudbury dealt with that?
Please, Next. Go ahead, Victor.
Sudbury does it through a percentage of their total residential tax levy. So they pick a number, and they do not exceed that number. So they may get a maximum benefit 1 year. If more people apply, they just adjust the benefit. Good thing about the senior circuit breaker program, it's means tested as well. And the benefit is already income adjusted based on what a taxpayer receives. If it's a higher income, the lower they would receive in a benefit. And Wayland has no cap. However, in Wayland, it is paid for through the overlay, which is a function of the calculation of the tax rate. So both ways, the burden is passed through to taxpayers.
I'm trying to get to people that haven't asked a question, and then I'll get back to the other ones. Go right ahead. One more.
Just as a follow-up, Mr. Arena had talked about how it would be good to include some type of policy that includes that vision to make the burden predictable. And I don't know how that would be done in a way that...
We wouldn't want it in the Home Rule petition,
right.
Certainly.
Right.
It wouldn't be in the petition, but the Selectmen annually visit their policies and, you know, could vote such a policy should they choose to do so. Now, that's not binding on any future boards, and, you know, it's a policy. You know, it's not a regulation. So.
But I think that policy really gives, I guess, faith in, to me, in this. Suggestion. I think knowing that future boards will work with the same vision that you have is important for the board to change. So I don't know how quickly such a policy would be written, if it could be available for town meeting to see, but I do think that vision is important to understanding.
It is important to understand that, yes, you're right, boards change on a regular basis, and policies of that board are changed on a regular basis. So you need to remember that although, you know, this board can be looking at things in a certain way, present something to town meeting, the town meeting puts forward, and then we could adopt the policy around the adjudication of that effort, and it's not going to be binding on anybody, you know, going forward. So, I mean, it's certainly something worth talking about, and I hear what you're saying. I think this lady had a question.
Your last statement about letting the voters decide on each of these components, can you just remind us on when the decision points are?
Sure. Well, I mean, that's part of what tonight's meeting is about. Part of what will happen, and Bob, you're going to have to correct me if I don't get all the dates right. Probably this evening we're going to vote to hold a special town meeting and hold a special election. Probably sometime before the end of the month, when we get in front of into a with FinCom and with the school committee, We're going to have wording together with an amount together if an override is in fact the will of the board. And so all of that likely will be, some of it will be in place tonight. Some of it will be in place by month's end as far as what it will look like. That will then roll out over a period, and we're trying to do this, we've had some discussions about this, as early as possible to give as much opportunity to absorb all of this, because it's a lot. I mean, it's really a lot. And if you're, you know, kind of brewing in it every day, it's a lot. So, you know, if you're just a casual observer of it, you need to have time. So the goal would be that sometime before the end of August, you would know that there is going to be a special election, there is going to be, you know, a ballot question relative to an override based on current prevailing tax recommendations of this board, which would be finalized, you know, later this year, that X, Y, and Z will happen. That's why I've felt that these need to be discussed separately to stand on their own merits, and then as each one of them does what it does, tax classification, you know, senior, you know, the home rule petition, and the size of the audit or the size of an override, some facts and information need to then come out to everybody so that they could look at it holistically over a period of about, I think then 6 weeks, October 16th, is that right, Bob?
Yeah, 18th. Maybe.
October 18th would be a special election to let the voters make a decision. So the goal would be have everything in place so that all the knowledge is there, all the facts are there, and have a 6 week period of dissemination of information and, you know, people being able to ask questions so that they can choose how they want to vote.
John, I just want to drill down with regard to schedule and who approves, more fully answer your question. The issues of, we were talking about tonight in terms of the home rule petition, would be put on a, it'll
be a warrant article for town meeting to decide, and ultimately would be forwarded to our legislators. So that one doesn't go to the voters per
right.
se. We have other aid measures in place for seniors that will also be on that town meeting warrant. The only thing that goes to the voters is the override. The selectmen have the sole purview of deciding classification, whether to shift taxes to CIP versus residential. Let me just make a comment about that, because there was a letter in the paper last week that I think was a little misleading, and I tried to call the person in question, couldn't get her. If we classify, if we shift the tax rate more heavily to commercial, that does not increase the tax levy. All it does is reapportion it differently among the two sectors. It does not raise additional tax revenues. So I wanted to add that on at the end.
At town meeting?
Yes, on September 12th.
September 12th, would vote?
There would be an article pertaining to this.
For the home rule?
Yes.
Before the override?
Right. There will also be an opportunity for town meeting to discuss but not approve the override.
So in right. some scenario, mm-hmm. approve the home rule tax relief,
yeah.
and then override the gas rejected.
It could.
Correct. Town meeting will have the opportunity to approve the home rule petition
right.
in advance of, that'll actually be presented to them should we decide to do that tonight. That should be presented to them as a warrant article on September 12th.
Right, here's the draft warrant articles. The relevant ones are articles 4, 5, and 6. As Victor mentioned, our standalone, if you will, small efforts at the most needy folks in town. Article 7 is the item in discussion right now, and that is a town meeting decision. If town meeting does not agree with senior tax relief, we stop right there. Town meeting must agree in order for us to continue. Article 8.
Well, could you say that again, Bob?
Article 7 will be senior tax relief.
Home rule petition.
Written up as a home rule petition.
You said something at the end of that about something being conditional.
I said that if town meeting does not approve Article 7,
yes.
then we stop right there. Town meeting must approve a home rule petition for us to continue.
Right.
To continue with Article 8?
With senior tax relief.
Oh,
senior
tax relief. Right.
All we can do is recommend an article.
Yeah.
And, you know, some form of that article will either be approved or not approved tonight by this board for inclusion in the special town meeting.
And the
town meeting will decide whether or not to go forward with a home rule petition. Should they decide to do that, it then has to go on through the legislature and DOR approval and all those kinds of things. But that would be a signal to the voters that, you know, this is potentially another item of taxation. And so they need to know all of that. That's why we're trying to get this, as much of this done as we can in advance. And that's frankly the reason that I've, you know, that I'm trying to limit the discussion to one piece at a time so it doesn't get overly confusing and we can kind of get from here to there. Yes, sir.
Why don't you move the election to next year?
There's a very important reason why we're not going to do that, which we're not going to engage right at the moment in the middle of this piece of the discussion. Okay?
It's such a huge complex issue, we need to move it out.
Well, it's been worked on for well over a year by a lot of people here at this table. So, you know, the idea of when the election is will come up in another piece of the discussion tonight. So if you'd like to stick around for when we get to that, we're happy to, you know, go over that with you. Yes?
I'm a little confused about the things that are being elected and by who. If the voters decide on an override, but the voters don't get to decide on the senior circuit breaker credit thing.
That is correct.
What I'm getting to is
the voters approve that or disapprove that through their town meeting members.
Well, these are these different components where we're talking about all these different things where people have in front of them and stuff that is do the right thing. And I'm not coming down on the seniors. I'm talking about everything. Okay. So you've got the senior thing. Let's do the right thing. Override on 2.5. Let's do the right thing. Here's this other thing. Let's do the right thing. There's all these things where supposedly do the right things, and if you did all the right things, now we're going to be negatively impacting certain people in this town that otherwise wouldn't have been impacted, and they don't get a choice on some of these things.
Wouldn't you agree, Mike, that probably the most important thing that this board can do is isolate those things for consideration one at a time, and then once those are all either for consideration or not, be presented as a package tied to the override vote for the voters? Doesn't that seem to make sense to you?
It sounds to me like there are things that are getting buried in the details here that we don't get a chance to vote on. And to this gentleman's point over here, and I've had this discussion with you before, we and I am not seeing enough education to the town about what's going on. This is the first I've heard of this tonight. You said you've been talking about it for a year. I just heard about this tonight.
At each and every one of the listening sessions, this was a topic of interest. And they were public meetings. They were promoted to all the same audience that this was promoted to.
I get the local paper. I don't remember seeing it. I might have missed it, but I don't.
Mike, I can't account for that. This is not the first time this discussion has come up.
All right, John, I think there's two parts to that answer. Yes, the senior relief part has not been discussed for the same time duration as the override. Override discussion has been well over a year, I can tell you that. The senior relief, probably 4 or 5 months.
Yeah, and in the public setting, at Board of Selectmen's meetings, as well as individual meetings to discuss the financial situation and to have listening sessions, those were conducted in May and June, Bob?
Yeah.
We had three of them.
And Mike, more to your point, I think if we put out every decision to the voters, we'd be at the ballots almost every day. So that's why you have an elected town meeting that is going to impact the residents of this town. You can't put it out to the voters for every item that comes before it. That's why you have those
unless
elected bodies in place.
Unless you have an open town meeting.
Well, you know, I can't account for any kind of a paranoid fear of fraud, because there is none here. I mean, you know, what's going on is a very high level of transparency on every topic. I can only tell you that this is going on in a public meeting place and has for an extended period of time on a variety of these issues. Now, what I'm going to do is bring this back to the topic at hand so that we can wrap this piece of the discussion up. There's lots of business left. Bill, I think this gentleman had his hand raised.
Yeah, Andrew Jackson from Gabriel Street. This actually goes way back to just
we're looking at. I understand the $85,000 a year limit. Is there anything in the state or in Sudbury or Wayland where they looked at past tax returns before, say, someone retires? Because I think there's a very good point made about even if you have the maximum earnings from Social Security, you're talking about $48,000 to $50,000 a year. So there are people who have intelligent tax advisors, financial consultants, who could hide their income and they could double up on this tax burden when they truly probably don't deserve it. So is there any way to look into any amendments or anything like that that says, before you retire, if you're making $200,000 a year for 3 to 4 years, you're not going to be eligible for this because, you know,
I can't speak to that. Victor's looked at it more closely, but I think we're trying to adopt the model of the circuit breaker, and it's only my guess that you only look at the most current year. Is that true?
The last calendar year. Yeah. Plus, mind you, when people submit their income taxes and when they would apply for this type of exemption, like all other exemptions, you sign under the pains and penalties of perjury. You know, sometimes folks do.
But it's not always perjury. There's a lot of different ways to avoid yourself being listed at $85,000 of income a year and still be worth a lot more in terms of assets.
It's true.
We do know 642 people
get
the exemption in town.
I was just asking if there are any examples. No problem. Thank you.
Bill, last word on this topic?
I'm not sure we're on the topic.
Well, then, Bill.
We had a young lady walk up because she didn't feel she had the right to speak. Under the open meeting laws, she does not. It's up to the chair. So people should understand the open meeting laws. It's strictly up to the chairman of the board of selectmen who may not speak. Congratulations, people. Thank you. Thank you.
Bill?
Yeah, even though we disagree.
So I think I really do appreciate the public comment and questions on this very specific topic of senior tax relief.
Before we leave it,
yes?
One comment. I think tonight is a microcosm of what's going to happen at town meeting.
Absolutely.
So we'll all be very wise to have prepared material that addresses these proactively. You know, multiply tonight through 5-6.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I mean, you know, that's kind of, as I said to somebody earlier tonight on the topic of, you know, a whole different topic, cemetery garage. We need to air everything in public so you have the opportunity to do one of two things. Either vote through the influence you have on your town meeting member on that topic or directly at the ballot box on those things. So by all means, I think you're right, John, you know, there's going to be a lot of discussion and there's going to be a lot of questions and we have to have a lot of information. And I think actually we haven't even gotten to all the information that has been assembled here in the interest of time. Yeah.
Two important things, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I wanted to ask Bob, in your discussions with the legislators, would the form of relief that they are envisioning that the state would provide do the same thing, in other words, reallocate the taxes among the residential sector, or would that provide some state relief on the state tax form?
The way state tax policy is written, that should be the default. They would have to really change state tax policy to spread it out beyond the residential. That doesn't mean they can do whatever they want.
I'm not saying about spreading it among commercial and residential, but would it take the form of the circuit breaker and give you relief on your state taxes?
No way to know.
Because if that's the way it's heading long term, that strikes me as a much more equitable
solution. I don't think we know that, Dan.
And I'm still concerned that this could fall off the cliff in 3 years and leave a lot of folks without the tax protection. There's a second part to this discussion. We have not gotten into tax classification, and I think we actually have something to vote on there. So are we going to cover that on TV?
We are, as soon as we have a five-minute chairman's privilege to take a small break. And we'll
That's
come
small
right
enough.
Back to the tax classification portion. I'm sorry, I'm old. classification discussion. So with that in mind, I'm guessing either Bob, you or Victor or both have some comments you'd like to share with us before we get going there.
Sure. Just to cut right to the point and relate it to the senior tax relief piece. On this one page, you pretty much see the summary of the whole situation. Right now, the default is that the residential class would pay 100% of the senior tax relief.
Bob, this is assuming that senior tax relief gets, that we send it along and that it gets approved at town meeting and then it gets approved.
And this is assuming the cost in a given year is $1 million, which we've just heard we won't know until it happens, but this would be theoretically the most.
Yep.
So again, in that first column, 1.0, commercial pays zero. Commercial, industrial, personal property pays zero. And I showed you, this is what houses would pay. Single family houses, 175 down to 75 at these assessed values. As part of the November tax classification, the selectmen says what's called residential factor. That's whether or not you differentiate between residential and commercial, industrial, personal property on tax rate. Reading has the same tax rate. As was mentioned earlier, if $1 million of senior tax relief passed, the residential rate would go up 25 cents, and the commercial, industrial, personal property rate would not change. So, at this ratio here, a factor of 1.02, you would have roughly equivalent to the family tax rates between the two classes of property, which means $1 million, $80,000 is paid by the commercial, industrial, personal property class of property.
$92,000 is paid by residential, and that's in today's proportion of 92-8 between those classes. So again, at a factor of 1.02, residential class picks up 92% of the cost and commercial picks up 8%, which is the current ratio of those classes.
So Bob, I see a lot of confused people.
Okay.
Did you have a question?
So what's the 1.02 mean?
It's just a factor. It is called the residential factor. It's no more complicated than that. It's the ratio of...
So that's basically at which...
Right now, we have a multiplier of, today, we have a multiplier of one for all classes of property. So it's a one, all right? Now, what this is now beginning to demonstrate is a what if. So what if, you know, the home rule petition, as we've discussed, goes forward? And what if $1 million was claimed under that home rule petition? The law says that the residents have to pick up 100% of such a home rule petition. Okay? So what this is a demonstration of, currently, for all intents and purposes, we have 92% of our property is residential property, and 8% of it is commercial industrial property. And so the line Bob is working with you on there shows a direct correlation between that those percentages and applying a 1.02 as a split rate to a commercial property in order to gain parity on a home rule petition. So that's what really what it's doing. So what it's doing is in relationship to the amount of commercial property versus the amount of residential property in order to share the load between of this imaginary $1 million. The dollar amount is somewhat immaterial to the discussion. It's the percentage amount. If it was $642,000 in Victor's other example, I mean, the percentages would continue to match. But what's happening here is you're seeing parity, you know, because the way the law is currently written, commercial property would pay zero on such a home rule petition. So,
and let me start at the end points. If you, you
let's
know,
just
if
listen.
The, if the board wished the residential sector to pay all the cost of this, it would leave the factor at one. That would be accomplished. If the board wished to transfer all the cost, $1 million, onto the commercial, industrial, personal property, a factor of 1.19 would do that. You can see no impact on residential down below at 1.19. So those are the boundaries, if you will, of who pays that million. Now, the factors do all kinds of other things, but we're only talking about $1 million theoretically and dividing it up, just for an illustration. And then there's midpoints. You can just see that, you know, if you were to split it 50-50, which Barry had asked at the last meeting, a factor of 1.10 would split this $1 million about $500,000 to each
class.
Property class. And you can see other examples. And again, if you will, the current break-even is the 102, which splits it in the proportion that taxes are currently paid, 92% residential, 8% commercial, industrial, personal property. So if you will, this is a tool, this is the only tool the selectmen have to override the default of state law, which is only the residential class can pay for senior tax relief. As I discussed with the board, that's just the way tax policy is written in Massachusetts. There's no magic about that. It could have been written the other way. It could have been written, if you give this relief to this taxpayer of any consequence, all taxpayers pay the cost. That's just not how the way it was written in Massachusetts. So these are options. These are sort of boundaries of how to share, if you will, the cost of the $1 million by using the tax factor, the residential factor.
I'm not to confuse it, but is it accurate to say that is the amount of $1,800,500 that the CIT would cost?
John, if the amount that was shifted goes up or down, the relative spread of this number would go up or down. So 1.19 shifts a million. If it was 2 million, you'd need a higher factor to shift all of that to the CIP. And likewise, if Victor's guess that maybe you only get 600,000 in the first year, then it's 1.015 or whatever it is that's really the middle point.
So for all those at home trying to do the math, just to simplify it, we're freezing for the moment the benefit, the conceptual benefit.
Right.
This is not what we're going to settle on, but just for the purposes of evaluating CIP, imagine $1 million of benefit levied on the residential portion, about 92% of our tax levy. State law doesn't give us the latitude to spread it over the full 100%. The only other tool we have is CIP. And this is, in effect, reestablishing the longstanding principle in Reading that the share residence to commercial would be equal. That is, there's no bias in the tax rate. We don't have a way to do it other than to nudge the CIP in the other direction to put equal burden on both groups' shoulders.
That would be column at 1.02 that you just described, John.
Right.
Correct, yep.
And so that's,
this is a move of CIP to offset a move that was made elsewhere.
Right, and it's illustrated reasonably well by, if you actually look at the dollar costs, you remember we mentioned earlier, or I did, that small businesses are approximated by those first two groups of commercial, under $1 million for a standalone small business. And again, at 102, the cost would be $100 or $200, somewhat similar to the cost of a homeowner, $100, $200. So again, it's, if you will, showing parity, and I don't mean to be making a political statement, just a financial one. Obviously, as the value of commercial property goes up, the numbers go up. So the, you know, bigger values pay substantially more. But this keeps the same ratio. The class as a whole has paid 8% its share of the $1 million. And I guess most importantly, the measure you have is the tax rates for both, again, will either be identical or within a penny.
Barry. So this has been a great discussion, and I really compliment my colleagues here for really taking on a really tremendously difficult topic at a time when we're really trying to figure out how we're going to pay for our services and keep people in their houses. And we opened up the door to looking at tax policy, which means that we've opened up the door to look at tax policy. And while it's true in the past, we've maintained a single tax rate. I think this discussion kind of leads us into the realm of thinking about, should we be looking at a different distribution of the taxes? So for the last hour and a half, we talked about, is it good public policy to try to keep aging seniors with limited income in their homes. And we talked about kind of the formulas, but nobody said that was a bad idea. So if you agree with that, then the next question is, should we as a community, all of us in the community, all classes of taxpayers, share in the cost of that benefit to keep the town of Reading looking like the town of Reading? That's the discussion that we're going to have now. If we keep a factor of one, that means that residential taxpayers are going to have a higher tax rate than Chili's and Home Depot. If we keep it at a factor of 102, it basically means the tax rates are going to be the same, but 90% of that tax relief is going to get borne by the homeowners. So now the question is, what's really the amount, what's the, you know, what percentage of this burden should be split between the different classes of property? Is it 25% on the business, 75% on the residential? Should it be 50-50? And if we look at those, factors, that means that the factor is going to go up. Now, everybody here doesn't want to pay any more taxes. I mean, that's really clear. But one of the things that we have to kind of figure out is sort of how is this going to be distributed? We saw from the previous slides that roughly 50% to 60% of the residential, the commercial properties in town are assessed under $1 million. And over and close to 60% of the residential properties are in the 500 to 600, or up to about 600,000. So essentially, the burden, the people who are paying the taxes the most are residential homeowners and the classes of property under $1 million in commercial. So I would argue that it's fair to look at splitting it, if not 50-50, then 75-25, residential and commercial, because it benefits all of us. It benefits business owners if seniors have more money in their pocket to spend. Where are they going to go? They're going to go to the downtown stores and spend money. Now, the other argument against splitting the tax rate is that, well, you know, it's going to put Reading businesses at a competitive disadvantage. And I just want to share some numbers with you. And this came up last time when we did classification. We do it all the time. Look at the towns that touch Reading. And I want to focus on Melrose, Wakefield, Stoneham, towns that look a lot like us. The commercial tax rate in Melrose is $18.78 per thousand. In Wakefield, it's $27. In Stoneham, it's $22. Right now, our tax rate's $14.50. If we split it 75-25 or 50-50, the commercial tax rate is still going to be substantially below our towns. Those towns have a thriving business community and have been doing it with a higher tax rate. So my argument is, or what I'm suggesting to my colleagues here on the board, is that we look at a factor of 105 to 110, and we really distribute the burden of that tax relief on the entire community, because it's really going to benefit the entire community if we're able to keep seniors here, and we should pay for that. So that's where I kind of started to throw it out as sort of a position about, if you believe that we should have to help the most vulnerable, then we should all pay for it. And keeping it with a lion's share, 92% of that falling on the homeowners, I think is not the right way to go.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I'd like to thank my progressive colleague for his comments, and I would like to add two of my own. First, I'd like to highlight two themes here. The need to simplify this so it can be explained to people, and the law of unintended consequences. Let me talk about the second first. Nobody's mentioned this tonight. It just occurred to me. If we vote to put this in effect as a home rule petition during FY17, however we decide on a CIP shift, two tax bills have gone out already for FY17. Necessarily, any increase in that column will have to be borne in quarters 3 and 4. You're going to be hitting people with a huge tax increase that they have not anticipated in FY17. There's a remedy to this. There's a lot of good things we've talked about. But as I said, this has not been under discussion anywhere near as long as the override. What is the harm of deferring this discussion until a town meeting next April? By then, we will know the fate of the override. We'll have more time to do research, and we can apply this to FY18, where it rightly belongs, coupled with an override. And that town meeting can be informed whether the override passed or not. I'm going to make a motion to commit this back to the board and to our assessor when the motion is made, so that this can be done. And I think that's the right solution.
Are you talking about the classification? You're talking about the whole senior.
We'll talk about classification. I think the classification becomes more moot if we're not going to. We're really bringing this up now because of this classification. I say the classification takes its normal course, and we don't deal with it tonight then if we decide to defer this. But I think it's a lot smarter to put this off till next April.
So simplify it.
How are you going to explain this to the people, John? I don't see how you're going to do it.
So let me just be clear. I understand exactly what you're saying.
Yes.
So are you suggesting that the discussion on the tax classification be tabled to a future time?
To our normal period in December, yes. If it's not, if we're not going to go ahead with this proposal here.
Dan's point is this is a moot point until the earlier discussion moves forward or not. This is only trying to offset the impact of the other decisions. That doesn't move forward.
So you mean Article 7?
Article 7, I would recommend we not go forward with this point if we don't pass this motion to approve it tonight. That would be my sense, that we don't
okay, so let's just kind of back up for purposes of clarification. Are you suggesting that the senior tax relief get tabled?
Just this piece of it. The other article should go fully forward. The idea of being able to defer to the sale of the home, the payment of the taxes at a reduced rate. Those are all fine to go forward. They're fully researched. They're vetted. I don't think there's any controversy about shifting taxes to different classes.
And so your point is, explain your rationale.
This is very complex, John.
Well, maybe I'll keep up. I'm a pretty simple guy.
We've been trying to grasp all that. I mean, it took me till tonight to fully grasp it. Folks in the room have been struggling with it. There are inequities that are created for folks, for younger families. That's a reality. We have to acknowledge that that's true. There are other means seniors have, and I'm a senior, and I have those means in writing. There are reverse mortgages. There are all kinds of other ways to get relief. We do have the circuit breaker. But I'm not saying we don't deal with it. I'm saying this is not the time. You're going to so complicate this override discussion if you push this at town meeting that it's going to jeopardize it rather than help it. That's my sense. And I've been through several overrides, John.
It's interesting.
Well, I've been through them.
We'll make it simpler.
It will. But I'm not saying never do it. I'm just saying not now. Not this.
I think now we're just going to get a personal opinion.
Sure.
My opinion is that the Home Rule petition on behalf of the seniors is the appropriate thing to do. The fact that it comes coincidentally at a time when there's other financial discussions, for me personally, means nothing. Okay? I just think it's the right thing to do. I think all of those things that are in the warrant articles leading up to 7, so I think there's 4, 5, and 6.
Yeah. Those are fine.
We should have done that years ago.
Yeah, absolutely.
Years ago. I mean, the fact that we have been asleep at the switch, us and prior boards, in my opinion, is unconscionable. I just honestly feel that way. Yeah. So that's just me, though. I mean, right. I'm one person, one vote. I think that I do understand that the Home Rule petition, if enacted, so correct me, Bob and Victor, if we petition for this, can't we select the year in which we want this to start? Won't this start?
Yes.
It doesn't have to impact.
What was the answer to that?
The answer is yes.
Yeah, you would put in the language effective FY18.
Yes.
But let me just also caution you that to get a Home Rule petition fully through takes 9 months.
I would be fine with it being an FY18.
Or even 19 if it takes 9 months.
I think that was my thought all along.
Well, not for 17. Absolutely not. Because that's going to really create a problem.
Because I think you're right. If you try to bring this in
state aid in the middle of the year.
Halfway in the middle. We're going to be speaking among ourselves, and then as we're done with that, I'm going to open it up to the public. Okay? And you're welcome to, write down your questions and come after us afterwards. Not afterwards, but, when we finish this part of the discussion. So I'm going to ask you to hold your questions until the board discussion is complete, and then you can have at it. Okay? So Dan, from my perspective, and I guess this is just, we probably haven't communicated to each other because this is the only place we do it.
Right.
It's in public. And my thinking has been all along that this thing enacts itself not in the middle of a tax year, at the beginning of a tax year.
That needs to be clear to Tommy.
And your point, without question, if we enact this mid-tax year, people will just blow their brains out trying to figure it out. Because, they're going to see a tax bill and they're going to go, what do they do?
Bob had his hand up.
As a practical matter, Brick has outlined a process that begins in August. It's not this August.
Right.
It's next August.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
So maybe we weren't clear enough about that up front. But the clear objective is FY18.
So why are we even talking about classification then, if it's for FY18?
That's up to the board.
Because
we can't go ahead to 18 classification. We don't sit as that board yet. So
you're right.
This is correct.
After tonight, they'll probably look a lot different.
I thought the vote was to give guidance.
Well, they're kind of married to each other. So.
Well, we're not the classification discussion.
Yeah.
Is not a binding discussion
right.
until such time as we have real
certified
numbers to work
rate.
With.
Right.
So I think it's to understand the general feeling of the board and to let the public know generally how the board is thinking about this. I think it's important for them to know that.
But Dan, it's important to discuss because if we move forward with the senior assistants, the question everyone then is going to ask, well, how much is it going to cost me, right? Well, it's going to cost you a different number based on what factor we decide.
That is true.
So if you think that as a homeowner, I don't want to pay 92% of this thing. I want to do it 50-50, right. Or I think the commercial people should pay.
So you deal.
Well, then we're going to do that for some of it. Then we're going to have a factor that's a tad higher.
You can't find a future board.
We can't find the future board, though.
Absolutely not. You have to take that up only when.
But I thought the whole point of having the classification discussion now was that we can then go to the voters and say.
That's the motion. FY17 classification.
Yeah, and obviously you can amend the motion.
No, you could. That's one president.
But you can't amend it to FY18 and have it bind.
Yeah,
no.
So I don't know what we're even able to commit to in this regard.
As far as timing goes, Bob, I know we usually take up tax classification in November. We don't have to take it up in November, right? That's why we're
yeah, you kind of do.
You kind of
no,
so
we can
right,
take it up
so
early.
Right now, anything
so
that we're talking
early.
About is a non-binding vote. It's just saying this is how we're probably.
You can't.
This is how we will vote come November.
You can't set tax rates today.
Right.
No.
You can't set
the numbers.
Hopefully in November.
We can set facts.
But can we?
But you can bind yourself now if that's your wish to all the four votes that you would be normally casting in November, and then just plug in the tax rates. I mean,
so we wouldn't be having this discussion then in November if we have it tonight.
You're free as a board to say something tonight and then say something else in November.
That's what I'm getting at.
Prevent that.
Okay.
It's the will of the majority of the board at each meeting.
Right. Okay.
But I think the reason, I think Barry's right, just to have this discussion, just understand so the community can understand what the board's
doing. Oh, I agree with that. Yeah. No, I'm just trying to find, just looking at the process more than anything else on that one.
Yeah.
Confused.
So, Bob, did you have more that you wanted to present?
No, just, there's a bunch of numbers out there.
John, your thoughts? John, wake up.
He's in siesta.
That's it.
Oh, there he is.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Get the mute button off.
Eventually, I have to take a bye over it, too, so I've learned.
Okay.
The thought of having 92% booked to the 8% for relief is just counterintuitive to me. I think 92% ought to fall on 92%, mm-hmm. and 8 ought to fall on 8. And that,
just sound logically, that's where we are today. We've always established parity, like it or not, that's where we've come from.
Right, but we've never done tax policy changes to the extent that we're doing now. So when you open up the door to that, you open up the door to looking at the holistic picture. Doesn't mean we can't do something different because we didn't do it before.
There's a difference between an open door and a Trojan horse. I'm not going anywhere near a SIP discussion that does anything but parity. Full stop. This is purely to support the senior discussion we just finished. Right. I'm not using this as an open door to go off and start playing with knobs and levers.
Correct.
The bigger issue in my mind is I feel very differently about the big box stores, like a Home Depot, like a Jordan's, who draw in from multiple towns with multiple tax rates, and that's an external comparison of their tax rates. The majority of the business owners in our town are sole proprietorships or small chapter S's. And they very much do care about the tax rate. I fully believe that what big box stores think about it just as a cost of doing business. They don't even think about the taxes.
Right.
But I got one lever, I got one knob to adjust both of them. And while it seems small, they're small businesses. And so we've got a finer tool that we can adjust it. I'm not moving on the SIP other than to reestablish parity. My principle last year was it's the same. My principle next year will be it's the same. With one caveat is if we can find a way to address the larger stores, who I think have a much different economic than we do the small businesses.
And John, so we can do that by shifting the tax rate. Because the biggest
Barry, please let him finish, and then it'll be your turn.
I don't see any logic to turn to 8% of the tax levy and say, please give the 92% relief. That's illogical. The minority, you're holding them hostage. They don't even have the votes to overturn this. They live in our community. They're paying on their business properties. They're paying in proportion to the value of those properties. We've always had a parity-based system. We're just reestablishing it. I'm not using this as an open-door policy to open this up into shifting 50% of the load on 8% of the tax levy.
Are you finished, John?
Done.
Barry.
We are looking at complicated public policy to our credit that basically tries to help a class of citizens. Isn't that the responsibility of every taxpayer in town, whether you own a home or a business? I say yes. So then you figure out, well, how do you do that? Is 50-50 too much? Maybe. Is 75-25 better? Maybe. But also, if you look at the impact on an individual tax bill, right, the lion's share of commercial properties are assessed under $1 million. The impact at, let's say, a 105 is $500. The lion's share of residential properties are assessed under 600,000. So you're looking at really small shifts in payment. And the biggest payments are going to be done by the people, John, that you're correct, are the ones that don't really care about their tax bill, the Home Depots and at Walker's Brook. If you look at the impact of what they're going to be paying, most of those properties are going to be paying the biggest share of it, right? I'm saying if we're going to open the door to tax policy, then let's look at how we do it in general. And I think it's just a moral obligation that if we're going to help a group of people, that everybody's sharing the cost and the burden of that. And we do that at 105.
Are you finished?
I'm done.
So I have some thoughts on this as well. And I think that what we can't lose sight of that we have not discussed as part of this particular discussion is there's a reason why the 102 is reflective of 92 and 8. It's because 92% of the value is in residential property and 8% of the value is in commercial property. And frankly speaking, in my mind, we have stayed at a parity level because there's been such a disproportion between commercial property and residential property. So much more of it has been there. Now, earlier in the discussion, very early in tonight's discussion, Bob put up something that talked about economic development, which Barry, I know you're one of the co-chairs of that particular piece of our 2020 plan.
And what Bob talked about was a Walker's Brook 2. Now, if and when that happens, and it's my belief based on the trajectory that we're working on, both in Barry's committee and in things that are that we've been working on in the background to try to develop this what little we have left, the economic development side, a Walker's Brook 2 is probably not a far-fetched thought. It's actually something that is believable. Now, if and when that happens, suddenly what I think you're going to start to see is instead of a 92 and 8, you're going to see, you know, like a 12 or 14 and 86, 88. Now, once you do that, once you get to the place, then this is the way, to John's point, John said he would love to see those larger type stores, those larger properties, who probably look at this in some cases as a rounding error, their real estate taxes, he'd like to see those grow. Well, the way that that's going to happen is not by taking the small business owner and making them pay more than their fair share. I mean, there's a certain parity issue here. The 92 and 8 in the earlier example is a creation of everybody pays their fair share based on the amount that they currently own in value. And if such a move was made with the home rule petition, in order to maintain parity, you would have to split the rate. And you'd split it at 1.02 in the million-dollar example. Because what that does is, in my opinion, Barry, keeps people paying their fair share. If I own, just because I am a business or a commercial property, that doesn't make me responsible for half the bill if I only represent 8% of the value of taxable property. So when you think about it in that regard, if at some point in the not too distant future, within the next decade, we have a Walker's Brook 2, then the idea of a true split tax rate that looks more like, you know, a Wakefield or a Stoneham or a Wilmington, that might make some sense to me. Now we're talking about my opinion and how I would consider voting. I would further say that, to me, when you tear these numbers apart and begin to understand about paying your fair share, a small business is at higher risk than a big business, even though the big business is going to have a bigger hit on the tax increase. And I do understand small business. I've owned several. Don't currently own one. But here's what I know. I know that everybody should pay their fair share, and if you look at the numbers that were put up there, put those other ones back up at 92 and 8, now suddenly what you start to see is everybody's paying in that kind of a split tax rate. And you know what? I do think everybody should pay. I don't think that the commercial property owners should be exempt from protecting the seniors for all the reasons you mentioned. Look, business owners are going to benefit by seniors staying in town. Because frankly, seniors probably spend more of their spendable dollars in town than millennials, because millennials are spending it where they work, which is probably not in Reading. I mean, we know this to be true. I mean, all you have to do is go speak to a small business owner in this town and you realize that they really wish they had a bigger share, but they don't. So the small business owner, you know, would get hurt, but what is the proportion? If I own a commercial piece of property, and it's worth $500,000, it costs me $90, right? If I'm a residential property owner, it costs me $115. That seems to me to be parity. I mean, if I own a commercial building worth $500,000 and it costs me $90, and I own a residential property and it's worth $500,000 and it costs me $115, the delta is not very big. You know, the delta is $25 on a $500,000 piece of property. So should everybody pay their fair share? I think they should. And I think because of the way Massachusetts law is written, if we go forward successfully with a home rule petition at that point in time, and only at that point in time, we're going to need to make an adjustment in the in a split rate that makes things, keeps them at parity, keeps them the way they are. The time for a significant commercial rate split, in my opinion, is when we have a larger share of commercial property in our town, when it actually can have some reasonable bearing. You cannot compare Reading to Wake to three of its neighbors. You can't. And the reason you can't is if you look at their percentages. Victor, what is the split?
They're not drastically different.
85-15.
85-15 in Wakefield. So that's my point exactly. When we get there, if I'm still the guy sitting here, which is unlikely, you guys are going to have to haul me out of here probably long before then. But, if you had that kind of a split, then you could engage a discussion with me about splitting the tax rate in a way that, let that move itself. But I don't think under these circumstances you can't.
Mr. Chairman, are we substantially in agreement on the timing? Not the merits, but the timing of everything. This discussion on the CIP ought probably happen 1 year from now, in advance of FY18.
I think it's important for people to understand how we are thinking about things. Barry asked for the discussion. I agree with him. This is a very important discussion. And, the voters should know, citizens should know how, their executive committee is thinking and, what their thoughts are on this. So I think it's a great discussion. I mean, I'm one of five people here, so we're going to vote on what the wording is going to be on this home rule petition. I have been under the impression that 18 was the fiscal year we were at.
Can I add some friendly language to that effect in our motion? And I think
when we get there, yeah, sure, by all means. I want to keep the discussion. Yes.
If I might just add that, as the board knows, the public may not, one of the tools the board has at tax classification is a small commercial property exemption.
Right.
Because of all the moving parts, I asked the board not to consider that right away, in other words, this fall. There's too many other moving pieces. But it certainly would be most appropriate to do it a year from now. And what that does is it looks at the commercial sector below $1 million of assessed value. And again, the state has given us a very imperfect tool, but some of those property owners could be exempt from the full tax burden.
So the smaller businesses could have a protection mechanism very similar to what we're trying to do with the seniors.
Right.
And there are 43 of such businesses, as I remember, Victor.
I don't remember.
I think we had this.
It was somewhere around that number.
It's about
that. They could possibly qualify for the parameters of the small commercial exemption,
right,
which is a 10% exemption amount in taxes.
Okay. So there is that tool to be worked into this potentially, but in the future, not today.
There's nothing simple about tax classification in Massachusetts. Aware of that. For anybody that hasn't had a close look at it, you will run out of the building screaming if you really look that closely at it, because the state doesn't make it easy. For whatever reason, I'm not sure, but, we have to deal with what we have. Are we kind of a one mind on this idea about the dates of the tax classification? Because I think that's important to the balance of this discussion.
For fiscal year 2018, is that what we're?
I think that's what Dan brought up, and I think I actually thought that's what we were talking about. But I think
we lost him. He's coming back.
You there?
Yeah. I just jumped in the middle to grab something.
Okay. Dan points out to do the home rule petition mid-tax year, which is the way we've, in our packet, it's worded.
But I am all in favor of moving forward with this motion to present at the town meeting on Article 7 with that stipulation.
Okay. And if that's the case, then, generally, do you feel that way, Barry?
I'm in favor of a senior
of the home rule petition concept.
Of the concept, I think we have disagreement on the.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
But
so
I am in agreement on that.
Okay, so I guess, and the reason I'm asking this question is, if we're generally in agreement that, you know, and we'll get the wording of the petition right and all that, that we're moving towards an 18 implementation date, should it clear all of its hurdles? First being town meeting, second being legislator, third being the governor, and lastly, you know, stand up the DOR review. Let's assume that that all happens. If it's 18, it's probably going to, it's going to take till then anyway.
Sorry.
That'll give Victor the time a year from now to collect the applications.
Or quit.
And so
that's a 9-month process. Are we looking at 19?
Did I say that?
No. I think, I hope not.
I'll say not earlier than that point.
Okay. So, but yeah, I think we'll have some indication as to where it's going to go. So I guess where that brings us next is, if that's the case, I really think that this is both a spirited and a productive discussion on the split. I think it's really important for us to have this out in public. And look, business owners, commercial property owners need to understand that it's the feeling of this board that should A happen, B probably has to happen in some number. I haven't heard anybody say don't create at least parity. I have heard, you know, we need to get it bigger, we need to keep it even, and probably several things in between. But I think it is important for the business community to understand that if A happens, B is going to happen in some number. That seems to be where everybody I've heard speak up here is inclined to say that that's probably something worth looking at. Do you have more discussion?
I mean, this is a discussion we have every year, and I'll keep fighting the battle every year. So, you know, and it'll get discussed at town meeting as part of this whole process. So, you know, I thought I made my position pretty clear.
Yes, indeed. You have.
So procedurally, Mr. Chairman, are we going to take two kind of structural motions to ourselves on classification this evening, one for FY17, one on FY18?
Well, I don't know on classification that we're going to.
We do not need to deal with that tonight.
This board won't be in business as this board when this topic comes up, when, you know, the home rule, should it clear all its hurdles? I mean, this board, you know, has got two members coming up for election, and the board has not been reorganized or convened in time for that tax classification discussion. So I personally, you know, don't see a vote around tax classification. I see a discussion.
That's fine.
I do see a vote around the the senior item, the tax relief. Yeah, Barry.
Although I think if I was a town meeting person who hasn't really tuned into this discussion tonight, I'm going to get to town meeting on September 12th, and I'm going to hear a presentation about a program where we're going to basically move $1 million away from low-income seniors onto.
You got to leave the million out, Barry. It's not a million.
Well, I mean, that's the number that we're. I mean, those are the numbers that have been talked about. Some number away from low-income seniors, and the only way right now, without sort of guidance, is that 100% of that's going to fall on the homeowners. So I think it's important for us to give town meeting some guidance, saying that whatever number that we're going to vote on, or that this is how we're thinking about it. Because right now, if that gets enacted without any type of movement in the factor, 100% of that is going to fall on the homeowners.
It's an interesting topic that you bring up, Barry, because you're right. You do want to at least explain to town meetings, to the voters, that they understand this is what it would look like. The other side of that, though, is there's no guarantee that that's what it will look like. So, you know, I don't know how you get around that problem.
Just times two of the motion, do one for FY17, and they're both instructions to ourselves for future actions. Mm-hmm. At least we'll give them a sense that we are thinking ahead. I know it's not.
I mean, do we really have to have a motion to instruct ourselves to think something at some time in the future?
Actually, for 17,
the procedural part of this is not grasping me.
18 about doing 17.
You know, I get that I'm, you know, I
think the problem is that the public is going to want the other half of it, even if they can't vote.
We'll tell you later. 17.
Reestablish the playing field.
Right.
I think that's the problem. problem. It encumbers the discussion.
Right.
You can't tie your hands for a future vote.
No.
The other way to do it, I'm not sure if a home rule position, is there any way to condition the turn-on date other than 2018 to an even later date?
Dan was going to address that in a motion.
I'll put something in.
So, what I'm getting at is, could you test the will of the public?
Right.
And leave open the date of implementation, and then knowing that it's the home rule moving forward, then vote to six prior to the home rule taking effect.
So, John, let me ask you a question. How do you mean, tell me what you mean by sense the will of the public. Tell me what you mean by that.
There's two issues here. One is, does the public agree with the concept of the there's a problem in the discussion when people say it's good about the commercial stuff.
You got to get in a quieter place, John. We can't hear you.
On a party line.
I'm sorry.
You got to get out of the bar.
Let me try to
look here. No denial, you'll notice.
Why don't you guys continue to talk about shit, though?
Thank you, John. I think that we can go round and round about this. I think it's important to open some questions to the public on this particular topic while we're convened here. Yes?
On this topic, I do think that for a town meeting, it's going to be important that we know sort of where the board is on this. And I think there's been a lot of discussion about the commercial tax rate. I think that it makes really logical sense to, as you look at this 92%, 8% in that mirror as the property. So, and if you, obviously you can present whatever data you want to town meeting, but at least it would give the ability to sort of focus in on a scenario to help people understand it. And I also think that will give the whole senior tax relief, which is really important, the best opportunity to pass town meeting, because any voters or members who are sort of concerned about the other things we've heard about, lower income people, may feel like, well, it's not just my burden. So I don't know how you go about doing that, but I do think that it would be important for town meeting members to sort of know what the board would intend.
Yeah.
It's no guarantee on action, but sort of what the board would intend.
Yeah. I mean, it's really a straw vote. I mean, it's not a binding vote on anybody.
Right.
And procedurally speaking, Bob, I mean, are you thinking of a way that you could actually...
Without time travel?
Yeah, without time travel,
I think it's important to make two comments. One, motion on senior tax relief is vital that you make it tonight. In order for town council to come back next week and present you with that's...
Yep.
That's
for the for the tax classification.
Yep. Right.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that actually makes
for
sense.
That's for the senior tax relief.
For the senior tax relief.
For the tax classification.
Home rule petition.
It's really more of an optics thing. It's what optics does the board wish to present to the public?
Right.
The simplest way to do it, Dan mentioned two motions. The simplest way is upon implementation of senior tax relief, this board believes that a factor should be X. It's just a simple statement.
Okay, that's okay. I mean, I think that fits. It binds nothing.
No, it binds nothing.
And doesn't put a year on it either.
I think that's a motion that could be worded. Is there other public comment or questions? Yes?
Hi, Samantha Kerr from 44 Middlesex Ave. And I really appreciate all of the discussions you're having on this. And it was due to me that this would be completely separate from an override senior tax. Relief, and I just feel by sequencing the votes this way, by putting the relief to the town hall meeting on the 12th, you've said many times you don't want to pit populations against each other, but I feel like it's essentially going to be doing just that, maybe even a third population by the tax shift, and just people's priorities in terms of what happens on October 18th. That whole discussion is going to get muddled based on this if it goes forward, and I would just I would love to see either be part of that discussion on October 18th, somehow tied to the override, or pushed back until afterwards, because I think that we might as well take the override off the table if you're going to move forward with this. People aren't going to tolerate two increases in their taxes, no matter how it shifted.
Which people? The people that were speaking as seniors, or the people that were speaking as younger people?
I think in general, both populations.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Rachel Hitch.
Yes, Rachel.
That's not fair. I think we were talking about the fact that we're now looking at three things that are the right thing to do. We all want to do the right thing. We want to support seniors staying in their homes. We want to support the town providing services and keeping people employed and providing high quality jobs for very smart people like Victor.
We met.
We didn't know there was a plant in the audience, Victor.
Everyone's spoken about this at different points in time. At the end of the day, we're doing a pocketbook discussion. How much will this cost me? And when we keep adding these numbers on top of each other, the right thing to do gets really difficult.
But you realize we're not saying this: the senior tax relief home rule petition is going to be tied to an override, right?
It is not.
It's standalone. Okay. No, I just wanted to make sure that, because I could see that as being an even bigger issue if you thought that way.
Correct. So we have, right now, we've laid out kind of three stages of different populations who have a stake in the game, and everyone wants to do the right thing. And by the end of this sequencing, we've got a bunch of populations who have competing priorities, and I don't think that's where you started when you talked to
it us. Isn't our intention to have them compete. I absolutely agree that it's never been the goal. It's been exactly the opposite goal, you know, and that's been stated now, honestly, for a very long time, for probably a year, that, you know, as override discussions started to percolate in earnest, which are really about a year ago. I mean, they've been talked about longer than that, but it's been the goal, I think, of every elected and appointed person who's had input to not pit one against the other. I agree with that, Rachel. However, here's the problem. If you address only the needs of one group versus the other group, then the opportunity to collaborate as three diverse groups gets minimized. So generally speaking, I mean, you know, I've spent my life in the business world, and much of that is negotiation. And what I have discovered is that if everybody doesn't win, nobody wins. I mean, honestly, that's been my own personal experience. So when you think about this in that context, so if I'm a senior, let's just kind of think out loud for a minute. If I'm a senior and my children are all raised and and I'm concerned about my tax bill, and do I want another override? I don't know. Maybe I do to protect my property value, but maybe, you know, I'm thinking twice about it. I'm thinking in a little different way. So my wife and I might be thinking in a very different way from the way our children would be thinking, because they have kids and the kids are in school. So now those are those two groups. So if the senior has the opportunity to feel like, oh, I'm being acknowledged, I have a stake in this in many ways, and it's been acknowledged that, you know, maybe there are some among my group that need to have, you know, they need to have a win out of the deal. And then those who have children in the school system feel very strongly, and I do understand why, that we don't want to go on our march from good to great to go from on our march to good to not so great. So that group has got to, you know, they've got to have a little something. Now, the third group I think you're referring to are the commercial property owners. And you know what? Commercial property owners have been before this board for the 3 years that I've been involved with it, and they've said, don't do it. Don't do it. look at the averages. And all we've ever looked at here are the averages. And those averages, if we looked 1 year ago, well, last November, said the average business is going to pay $2,900 and the average homeowner is going to save $100. I looked at that and I went, that's crazy. That doesn't make any sense to me. That a business, and I'm thinking now of, you know, a lot of small businesses right up the street here. I mean, why should they pay $3,000? I only save $100. I shop there. It's going to cost me more than $100 when they raise my prices. So what we did is we said, no, let's understand. Let's really drill into what's going on. And what we start to understand is that 71% of the businesses are worth less than $1 million. And if what you did was split the tax just for parity's sake, just to keep them even with the residents, in order to help them keep seniors in town, because we know they spend more money, what's it going to cost them on average? It's going to cost them about $90 or $209, depending on whether you're a $1 million business or a $500,000 business or a $1 million business. So does that third group win a little too? I mean, when you start to try to create something that everybody can embrace, everybody's got to have an understanding as to what they get. The commercial property owners get to keep seniors in town. Those seniors spend money with them, and the costs are really fairly marginal. The young families who are desperately interested in their children's education gets an override, and that causes the override, that causes the schools to do a continually good to great job. And same thing being true in the town. And the seniors who might otherwise, who I will tell you, vote in this town in much higher numbers than anybody else, those people feel like they've been heard. So kind of in that scenario, everybody wins. Everybody gets a little something. Yes?
That just seems to me a rationale for tying them together, though, because everybody doesn't win if you put one vote first that actually just goes to the town.
Well, there's certain legal sequential order of how you have to do what you have to do. So, for example, you can't put the senior thing on a special ballot. It has to go to town meeting. In order to get it to town meeting, you and get it done so that it's done in time for a senior to understand that they're being recognized, you got to do it now. And you have to have it do it on September 12th.
And the formal vote on classification for FY17 will not happen until...
No, but we can do a vote that's going to demonstrate the feelings of the board. And maybe it's parity and maybe it's a bigger number. But the point is, I do understand that, you know, everybody wants their interest, and they don't want it at the expense of everybody else. I know that's true. I honestly really do believe that. So if somehow your elected officials can package, you know, a comprehensive look that lets everybody really understand it the way we're talking about it tonight, I think it improves the opportunity for everybody to have a little seat at the table and feel like they didn't win everything they wanted, but they won enough to be a good neighbor and go forward. And I think that's the goal.
And so that, you know, I think, you know, if there was a way, I think all of us would want all three to be pulled together. So as much as you can do to work on that packaging and really link it, not in a legal way, but in the way that you're talking about, this is
in the explanation way. Is that what you're talking about?
This is right to do for the town in all of these different components that makes the town healthier. And then I think we come back to that drawing us together. Mm-hmm. As opposed to
this will not, if everybody doesn't pull together, it won't work. You are right about that. And I think the only way that can be demonstrated to the voters is not in a legal way, but in a continued open discussion. Part of the reason we want to get as much of this out of the way tonight as we can is to give us as much time between now and October 18th for people to understand all the facts and make their decision. I think that's really what it's about. So, Bob, Bill.
Who's the question?
You can't do that.
You can't do it, Bill. I know you want to, but you can't. Is there, yes?
Please, Ian, 8 Oakridge Road. I just wanted to chime in, and I wanted to earlier in the discussion, but wanted to wait till we got to the split tax rate to say that on behalf of businesses, and someone who's talking to businesses so often, I don't think it's the time to split the tax rate. I think that we need to work on our economic development, which I'm very glad to know that that position's in process and hopefully going to be built this fall, in addition to bringing more businesses, bigger businesses. A second Rockingport sounds great. Until we're over 10% commercial tax base, I don't think it makes sense to put it on businesses because it is an unduly small portion, and it's not parity because businesses have to pay for many of the services that we get through taxes. They have to pay for their own recycling. They have to pay for their own insurance. They have triple net leases. They have to pay for, I forget half my points because I'm falling asleep. Trash removal. They don't have the opportunity to put kids in school. So when I think of something like Doyon's Appliance helping to subsidize seniors, honestly, as someone...
So can I ask you a question along that train of thought?
Yes.
So I'm a residential homeowner. And I get trash, you know, my streets get plowed, and, you know, all of those things happen. And my kids get to go to school if, you know, they weren't ancient. They're old, too. They don't get to go to school anymore. But you left out a piece of that equation. Don't these businesses also have a revenue source that I don't have? I do not get revenue from owning my home. If I own a commercial piece of property, I have a revenue stream. And so that's the piece that, to be fair, I mean, I get that there's trash fees. I get that there's a lot of different fees. But there also is a stream of revenue. So you cannot lose sight of that. Yes, Barry.
Yeah, and I kind of want to respond to that as well. The town does all it can to support small business. We're looking at changing zoning so that we could, you know, bring in more mixed use to the downtown, so we have like offices so that there's more people working downtown. The town has done a lot to try to support small business. But if you are of the mind that there should be absolutely no split at all in the tax rate, and yet you still think it's a good idea to try to keep seniors in their home by giving some type of a senior exemption, what you're effectively doing is making the residential tax rate higher on your home than it is at Walkersburg. And it's just a fact. So if you think that people in Reading are going to support that, you know, I wouldn't, and I'm sure a lot of people wouldn't. They don't think that that's fair. So, I mean, the board is looking at a 1.2. My opinion should
1.02.
Be a
little...
1.02. That's what I meant. That was my...
nice burn.
No, 1.02. My feeling it should be a little bit higher. But if you do zero, you're making the homeowners pay a higher tax rate than the businesses do.
It's a reverse split.
So, and that is just, that's just homeowners subsidizing business. And that's just wrong.
I can continue. I do think that is putting,
me too.
We got to vote on this, John.
I think that we can't keep signaling out Walkersburg because your data shows that's like 12 businesses that are easily capable of paying more. And I wish by law we could tax them.
Can't.
I wish we could. To me, it seems that number one, there's a serious evaluation problem with commercial property, that it's not going up.
That's actually true.
No offense, Victor. I think you're doing a great job. I don't understand why.
I can do an hour dissertation on why that is.
Please don't.
They're wagging for a bit.
So the residences go like this, and the commercial's been so flat. I'm not a tax expert. To me, that doesn't seem to make sense, knowing that we're all here in the same community, enjoying the same, you know, great place. My point is that I think that, I'm like falling asleep right now. I don't want to say on record that I think Walkersburg, people in Reading should pay more than the Walkersburg businesses. That's not what I'm saying. I do think we need to focus more on bringing more businesses to town, and when we have a north of 10% rate, it definitely is worth looking into, and it's something to consider. I think we're too small. I think the 10 businesses in town are working on the, you know, the mandated overtime law, the increased minimum wage, the new paid sick time. We all know that there's a leakage problem in Reading, where people have such great conveniences in Burlington and in Linfield that a lot of people who live in don't shop here. It's a big problem because we do have so many conveniences in our life.
Wow, that Linfield thing, what a concept. I wish we could get something like that.
But I think that having a split tax rate and suddenly saying now we're, the homeowners are paying more than the businesses is an unintended consequence of a very good thing, which is supporting seniors. I think there will be many other unintended consequences of a higher tax rate. Even a modest 1.02. Running a nonprofit, I know that I rely, and many of us here rely on auctions, fundraisers, free gift bags, you know, raffle items for my own business's success. I need to get those from local businesses, from Robin here, and many of the other people who had to leave that came from on behalf of business. I think that's going to dry up, and I think that's going to be another unintended consequence of a good action, as she was saying. Protecting the seniors is very important. I agree wholeheartedly, but I just don't see it as a business responsibility. I think they pay extra. They have a lot of other fees, and
the senior discounts.
The senior discounts, and I also, you know that there's a lot of empty storefronts in Reading that have been like that for a year, from, you know, Walgreens to the wine shop to very quiet down on Haven since Portland Pilot with all the food traffic. I think it's a complicated issue. I appreciate that on paper it would be great if Home Depot and everyone there could pay more. I think that would be my goal. But because we can't do it legally, I'm very worried that there's going to be a lot of unintended consequences. And once we split the rate, it's very easy to slip, and the growth that we want to see, this new economic person coming on, hopefully in the fall, and the expanded smart growth district, we're going to shoot ourselves in the foot. That is my fear. It's going to make it harder.
Okay. I'm going to take two more comments, people that have had their hands up. Robert?
I'm Robin Crane. I'm a owner of Fitness Within. I think I want to just make some points here and something you guys need to consider. I think it's in Walkersburg. I'm not a franchise. I'm not the size of Chili's. We're a small, independent fitness studio. We're growing. We have now three trainers part-time, growing into full-time. You don't understand the impact that it would make on a small business like us, raising the taxes. And I'm not against tax raising. I just want it fair and equitable. If you bring more business into this town, I'll be right there behind you saying, I'll pay my fair share. But when you're saying we're only 8% of the entire town and that we're responsible, but you keep saying Walkersburg, you keep saying Chili's, we're not a Chili's. And there are so many other little mom and pop shops in town. The other thing I want to say is I don't own the property. I rent. I lease. I get triple net. And I'm going to tell you right now, my landlord is going to pass it right down to us. Mm-hmm. And so that's another expense that I have to worry about. So I get what you're saying, and I'm behind you. But I also think that Reading, for whatever reasons they haven't in the past, grown business, is part of the problem. And you cannot compare us to Stoneham and to Wakefield or Wilmington because their industry is higher and they have more of a share. And that's all I'm saying. It's just not equitable right now for small business.
So can I ask you a question, Robin?
Yeah.
Is it fair and equitable for a $500,000 house to pay $115 and a $500,000 business to pay $90?
If it's equitable, that's more equitable. But I'm okay. Just saying that you...
When so that's what we were... That's what most of us were talking about here.
100%.
Well,
no one was talking about 100%.
Well, we were until in November, December. There was like,
no,
we
that's
were
not legal.
Get the bulk of it.
No,
and
that's not legal.
Yes, Dan.
$3,000, that's going to come right down to us. My landlord is not going to absorb any of that $3,000. It's going to be passed down to us. And we don't qualify for all these other exemptions we're talking about because his business is a nonprofit, but he has a lot more people working for them. And we're only four people. So guess what? We don't get that exemption. So we lose out on that. So there's a lot of, you got to look at a lot of different stuff. But my big thing is, we're not owners of this property. We're small business. We're not franchises. We're not employees. We don't have the income and resources and lawyers to be able to deal with a lot of stuff. that these larger corporations can do when they have a tax issue or they have issues with the town. We're small, and you say you support small business, but I don't really see it. And okay. I love Reading. I've, you know, worked here many years, and now I own a business here. One of our, the other owner, he's wants to bring his family up here. He's young, and he chose Reading to open the business because he wants to be able to have his kid come after school to the studio. He wants his children involved in his life. And so wherever we went with the studio is where a place he wanted to live and eventually raise his family. And so, you know, he's not gonna be able to do that either. It's not saying that I don't wanna pay, but I'm also saying that right now we are 8%, and you're talking about Walker's Brook, you're always mentioning the owners, the business owners. We're not small businesses, we're just tiny. And we don't have the income. We're not getting the income from the rental, from the landlord. We're paying extra to him or her. And that's what I think I just want you to consider when you're thinking about this, is to keep in mind we are not owners of these businesses. You talk to all these property owners. Some of them don't have the businesses within their buildings. And right. That's what you just got to keep in mind. That's all I'm asking.
Okay.
It's fair.
Would the business people present agree that it was fair to charge the same tax rate to residents and to the businesses in FY16? Was that fair? We set the same tax rate for both?
Yes.
Would you agree it would be fair to do it again in FY17?
Right.
How about FY18?
It depends on everything. I mean,
yes or no?
So it really is a pretty simple question.
It's a simple
what
question.
What Dan is asking you is...
You were happy with it, the same tax
you've been happy with it at,
you asked
at one.
Right.
So that means
how
everybody pays 17? The same.
The same tax rate?
So at 1.02, everybody pays the same.
Listen to me. No, you're dodging my question, please.
No,
yeah, you are.
How am I dodging it? It's based on... Sounds great.
Okay.
But if there's other things that are going on in the world that requires us to be...
All right, I can't control the world, but I can tell you if you pay the same tax rate in FY18 and we have the senior exemption, then you are happy with a CIP shift of 1.02. And that's what I am going to recommend in my motion.
I don't know what this... I would have to look at everything. I think, again, it's...
Okay.
I need to know what the town is doing and where the, approximately a half and everything is showing, but right now, to today, we should not be looking at spurting the businesses any more than they are. And so we can start getting businesses in here and seeing that the town is really serious about growing this town. Because I hear it, but then you hear these horror stories from other business owners.
Okay, well, we're not going down that path, Robin. We're not going down that path tonight. Okay? We're not going down that path either. We're talking about tax classification, and we're talking about tax classification at this time, okay?
Wouldn't that attract more business if the taxes are effective?
What we know, what all the surveys prove to us over and over again, mm-hmm. is that a split has a zero impact on the new development of business. We know that to be a fact in Massachusetts, okay? So, and I don't want to argue with you.
No,
I mean, I understand the position that you're taking. The point Dan tried to make to you is the following. In 2016, this board voted to have an even tax rate, residential, commercial. If in 2017, we do exactly the same thing, which I'm inclined to think will probably happen, mm-hmm. because you will not have the implication of the senior tax yet, you're gonna be happy. I think. Now, if in 2018 we have the senior protection and this thing is set at one, is a split at 1.02, guess what? You're paying exactly the same as the residents. So I think that makes you happy.
I'm not disputing that. That's what I'm saying.
That's,
we don't know if that's going to go through. And that's all I'm saying is we've got to keep things fair.
Okay, so now you're going to see town and work, okay, because we're going to shut the discussion off and we're going to do two things. One of them is we're going to vote on the idea of moving the home rule petition. And Dan, I think you've got some wording for that.
Yeah, Barry, I took taking the liberty of.
I can't read your handwriting.
Okay.
So.
All right, fine. All right. Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the proposed senior tax relief home rule petition as discussed, and request that the final language allow flexibility in setting annual financial terms. And then I'm going to add the following sentence. I'll go slow for Paula. The board further stipulates that implementation of this petition shall occur not earlier than fiscal year 18.
I would offer an amendment to you, Dan.
Go ahead.
I would strike the sentence leaving open the read that back, the financial.
The board further stipulates that implementation of this petition shall occur not earlier than FY 18.
No, the line before that.
Well, that was in the original motion.
Yeah, read me the original motion.
Yeah,
after the comma.
And request that the final language allow flexibility in the setting annual financial.
I would strike, my amendment to you is to strike that and say that our multiplier recommendation is a range between 0.5 and 0.2.
2.0.
Oh, all right.
So in other words, what we do is we give ourselves the flexibility to manage when those Augusts start to roll up, and Victor says to us, when he meets us in the fall, this is what you have. You have this, you know, assuming everything goes forward. This is what you have. You have the opportunity to have this many people. It's going to cost this much money.
All right, that's
and what we do then is make a decision on the factor, you know, based on what's reasonable and prudent. And I say we, not because it's even going to be me, but because it could certainly be future boards. And it will be future boards that will make that determination. So that's the amendment that I would make to you, is that you'd strike after the paragraph or after the comma and include a factor of 0.5 to 2.0.
Sorry. So and request that the final multiplier be 0.5 to 2.0?
Yep.
And then continue on with the last sentence. Paul, you have that?
Yep.
Okay.
Do we need any language to describe how the multiplier is arrived at, or is this simply authorizing the range?
Well, we're going to write in that it's going to be based on the circuit breaker.
Yeah.
Okay.
As discussed, that includes that.
Yeah, as discussed is in the motion.
John, just for your benefit, I don't remember if it's Sudbury or Wayland. I think it was Sudbury. They have language of a range, of a factor much like that, with no other discussion. Just there is a range, and then it's their policy on how to deal with it.
Okay.
That
second that motion.
Discussion.
Bob, is there any advantage you see to having the simpler language that simply talks about range?
I think the amendment by John Halsey is the right one. I think that has already passed muster with the state, and I would think it would pass again. And it gives Ray exact guidance.
Okay. Thanks.
We'll do roll call.
Okay. Any other discussion? John Arena.
Yes.
Kevin Sexton.
Yes.
Barry Berman.
Yes.
Dan Ensminger.
Yes.
John Halsey. Yes. Okay. That passes 5-0. I would entertain a motion of information, I guess. What did we just say a few minutes ago about this idea of the of the split?
That what was that language you had, Bob?
Well, let me try this. Let's see what the Board of Selectmen adopt a residential factor of 1.02 for the fiscal year. I guess it had an antecedent here. The petition is enacted with the tax rate to be set at a subsequent tax classification.
Well, I think isn't the message that we're trying to say that upon enactment of the home rule petition.
Yeah, but it might not be 18. It might be 19.
I get it.
Yeah.
So just say upon enactment.
Upon enactment.
Enactment.
Did I say that?
No.
Okay. I mean, that's the parity. That's the parity.
Oh, I crossed it out. Upon adoption of this petition, adopt a residential factor of 1.02 for the fiscal year as enacted. Yep. Didn't mean to cross it out.
Okay.
Yeah.
With the tax rate to be set at a subsequent tax.
Did you get that, John?
I did. There's a problem in timing, though. I think if you set it at 1.02, you're committing yourself to $1 million.
We're committing ourselves to what?
To $1 million bucks of shift.
No, you're not, John, because that number is irrelevant of what the tax shift is.
Right.
All you're doing is giving political or public guidance, rather.
Just a proration.
When you actually go to set the tax rate, or a future board does, Victor will have provided more precise information. If your goal is precise, equal tax rates, it's probably not 102. It's something with a lot of other decimal points.
Yeah, it's probably, if Victor comes back and says it's going to cost $642,000 to fund the home rule petition for seniors, then, what's going to happen is, in order to achieve parity, which is the goal, that number's, if that's the will of the board at that time, it's going to be a number like 1.0187, just to,
We're saying the same thing, I think. Until you know the amount shifted, you can't know the...
That's correct, but we or any future board will not finalize this. This is for purposes of town meeting, understanding the will of the board. The will of the board is to achieve, at least with this motion, is to achieve parity between residential and commercial property taxpayers. And it's binding on no one, because it can't be.
Right.
We don't have any numbers to work with.
I'm in agreement with it.
Okay, any other discussion? Okay.
Second.
Okay.
You're going to have to get out there after.
To you again. Move that the Board of Selectmen, upon adoption of this petition, I assume that's sufficient identification.
Yeah, if I might, upon implementation of senior tax relief.
Right.
Okay. An implementation of senior tax relief.
Okay. Adopt a residential factor of 1.02 for the fiscal year in which it is enacted, with the tax rate to be set at a subsequent tax classification hearing.
Yeah, I think that's the spirit of it. That's the message to town meeting.
That's on the record now.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none. John Arena.
Yes.
Kevin Sexton.
Yes.
Barry Berman.
No.
Dan Ensminger.
Yes.
John Halsey. Yes. Vote is 4-1. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, how will this be presented at town meeting?
That's a really good question, Barry.
Over several months period.
Okay. I'm not sure. I don't know that I know the answer to that. But I think it has to be a matter of public record. I mean, it's the only way we can demonstrate a willingness to make a split for parity, or in this case, for parity.
No, just in terms of the presentation.
My opinion would be, we've had tables like this for you tonight. A table like that in front of town meeting would be a disaster. We need to do exactly what you just indicated and show the exact implication, if it happened today, with the understanding that this is an approximation for what might happen in a year.
So I don't know if that answers your question, but I think that's the right track.
And the selectmen are on record as intending to support this.
And I would just like for the record to be able to make a minority report when that's presented.
You're free to speak.
You're a town meeting member. You can say whatever you want. Have a ball. It's America.
Absolutely. We don't silence deniers here.
Okay. I think we need to get on to the item about special town meeting.
Okay. Move to the board. Is there anything, Bob, do you want to say anything before I read this motion?
No, on page CAL1, in calendar, is just the rationale for the time.
All right.
Move that the Board of Selectmen call for a special town meeting to be held at Reading Memorial High School Performing Arts Center on Monday, September 12th, beginning at 7:30, and for the warrant for the special town meeting to be closed on August 16th at the next Selectmen meeting. And is that a separate motion?
Yes.
Or?
Yes, that's one.
I'll second that.
One motion. Okay.
So it's one motion?
You second. Have just completed the first motion.
Oh, okay, good. All right.
Let's assume it's two. Yeah.
Right. Is this carry over to the next page?
No. That's a second. I do that as a separate.
That's a town. That's
you have two motions for this, Joe. One's for the election, one's for the town meeting.
So someone said that, right?
Yep. All right, discussion. Is there a second?
Second.
If there's no discussion, I'll take a roll call vote. John Arena?
Yes.
Kevin Sexton?
Yes.
Barry Berman?
Yes.
Dan Ensminger?
Yes.
John Halsey, yes. Please continue, Mr. Secretary.
Move that the Board of Selectmen indicate to the community their intention to call for a special election to be held on Tuesday, October 18th at the Reading Memorial High School Fieldhouse between 7 a.m. and 8 p.m. for the purpose of requesting an override of Proposition 2.5. The exact terms and language of the override will be voted by the Board on or before September 12th, as required by law.
Second. Discussion.
One quick question. Is it our intention to resolve this at our next meeting?
What was the question?
Is it, Barry asks, is it our intention to resolve the exact terms and language of the override?
I would hope so.
I would say yes.
Yeah, I would hope so.
I would say that would be a goal of the next,
I think you'd have to get that
next Board of Selectmen's meeting.
Get that out right away.
Yes, Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Is 16, if you're going to be discussing the override at town meeting?
Say again, Bill?
Is this mean that you're going to be discussing an override at town meeting? Because it is not the purview of the Board of Selectmen to, or town meeting to act on any
Understood.
Override. Yeah,
they're not going to be asked to act on it.
The moderator, we were thinking of giving a report only.
Right.
The moderator is not comfortable entertaining questions from the group under that format. Therefore, he and Ray came up with a warrant article that falls under the four corners of what you're talking about. So, no vote.
No vote.
Discussion.
There'll be no discussion?
No, there'll be discussion, but no vote.
Well,
it's a very unusual article.
I think that, quite frankly, is still out of order because town meeting has nothing to do with an override.
They have nothing to do with approving it.
But we believe that we, as a courtesy, Bill, and we're going to have to agree to disagree. We, as a group, have made a decision that it would be courteous for the Board of Selectmen,
right,
within whose purview all of this is, to, in a formal way, give information out to the town meeting. Since there will be other business being conducted that is germane to their authority. And while we're there, we think it's important, as a courtesy from one elected town group to another, to give them that information.
I think that you've got to look at Article 3 of the town meeting plan because it says that we should not vary from what we have done in the past.
Does it say should not or may not?
Okay.
That's why we have town council.
Yes, Mr. Ryan.
Are we discussing, Thank you, Chris. 87 Daniel Road. Are we discussing the override now?
No. We're discussing an election
date. That's what we're discussing
right now. Are we getting to the override tonight or not?
Maybe. I don't know. It's almost 11 o'clock. May I have to adjourn without
making a motion and continue?
Middle of a motion right at the moment. And that motion is tied to what you most recently read, Barry. And that has to do with a special election on Tuesday, October 18th.
5-0.
We did? We're good?
No.
We didn't vote on that.
I wrote it down to on the special election.
We didn't vote on that.
Special town meeting.
We seconded, but not.
R? Okay. So.
Yeah. I thought you called the roll.
John Arena.
Town meeting.
Yes.
Kevin Sexton.
Yes.
Barry Berman.
Yes.
Dan Ensminger.
Yes.
John Halsey. Yes. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, unless people want to stay here until tomorrow, I'm going to move to adjourn the meeting at 10:52.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
So in the form...
I've already had my beer.
Is there any discussion?
It's not discussable.
I would like to pass along, given the nature of the extensive public comment tonight, I just want to say to the public...
Thank you.
I apologize that we can't get to the last item. It's 11 o'clock. It's, you know, it's time to stop. And, you know, I guess you could blame the chairman for not truncating the public discussion. I felt it was important. So here we are, getting ready to vote on an adjournment.
and I just wanted to let you know why we're leaving off the last item.
Which will be thoroughly discussed next week.
Yep.
It'll have to be.
Yes.
All those, well, roll call in favor of adjournment. John Arena?
Yes.
Kevin?
Yes.
Barry?
Yes.
Dan?
Yes.
John Hall's a yes. The meeting stands adjourned at 10:55.
Thanks for hanging in, John.
Thanks, everybody.